Welcome to the fantasy audiobook, Hogwarts, I Can Inherit the Legacy of the Dead. Chapter 41. Mecca Anders took the letter from the owl's claws, tore open the envelope, took out the letter paper and unfolded it. It read, "Thank you for your letter, telling me such great news. Seeing that the Black family is about to fall, Creature is heartbroken and wishes to die in exchange for the safety of the Black family. Creature hasn't seen the old master for decades. I often miss the old master in these years. I can't wait to see the old master's letter." The Hog's Head Bar, October 11, 11 o'clock at night, Creature will be on time. "Thank you again, distinguished guest. October 11th, that's tomorrow." Mecca smiled, put away the letter, and took out a bottle of black potion, which is the Polyjuice potion. He didn't tell Professor Snape that he made two bottles of Polyjuice potion at the same time, and secretly took out the extra bottle just to meet the old servant of the Black family. Otherwise, it would be easy to meet acquaintances and be recognized when he went there. On the other hand, the old elf might really think he was deceived and turn around and leave when he saw that the visitor was an 11-year-old boy. "I remember that the hair of a middle-aged bearded man was added to this bottle of Polyjuice potion." Mecca smiled and didn't care. Anyway, he would borrow a black robe to cover it from head to toe. As long as it was not a woman's body, who cared what it looked like? He put away the Polyjuice potion, lay down on the bed, and waited for tomorrow to come. The Hog's Head is located in Hogsmeade Village, which is a village adjacent to Hogwarts. Therefore, professors and students of Hogwarts often go there for leisure and entertainment, or buy some things, or drink a glass of mead suitable for all ages in the bar. Mecca had never been there, and first-year students were not allowed to go there, so he asked the Weasley twins during the day and roughly figured out the way to Hogsmeade Village and the specific location of the Hog's Head in Hogsmeade Village. At around 10 o'clock in the evening, the night was getting darker, and Harry and Ron were already asleep in the dormitory. Mecca waited for a while, and when he was sure that no one knew, he got up from the bed and drank the Polyjuice potion. He looked at himself in the mirror and his face suddenly twisted and squirmed, looking scary. Soon his body bones trembled and grew. His body size was constantly increasing, and there was pain from the flesh being broken. Mecca gritted his teeth and said nothing. Finally, the long clothes and trousers on his body could not cover his body. The pain disappeared. He looked in the mirror and saw a middle-aged man with a beard. Mecca quickly changed his clothes, put on the borrowed black robe, wrapped himself tightly, and nodded with satisfaction. "Although this body doesn't look good, the posture is very upright and the muscles are full." Mecca found that this figure with this black robe is completely an ideal figure without looking at the face, and the more you look at it, the more attractive it is. "Yeah, the voice is also very low and full of magnetism." Mecca touched his throat and tested his voice in a low voice. After he adapted to this new body, he whispered a spell in front of the mirror. Suddenly, there was a tearing sound, and wings grew from his shoulder blades. The shadow on the ground had curled up to the size of a bird. Mecca flapped its wings on his back, and a black bat with deep eyes flew towards the lake and moonlight outside the window. "The most dangerous place is the safest place." This sentence is absolutely correct. Mecca flew in the wilderness against the fierce wind. The vision in front of him was wide. He didn't see anyone on the road leading to Hogsmeade. He didn't worry about being discovered at all. Soon, it slowed down, saw lights not far away, and finally saw a figure. A wooden sign stood on the side of the road, with the words, "Welcome to Hogsmeade Village," on it. "We're here." Mecca avoided the gazes of the people nearby. He entered from the edge and quietly turned into a bearded man in the bushes. Then he tightened his robe and strode onto the road. Most of the shops on both sides of the road were businesses. Looking all the way, none of them were closed. It seemed that the people here also had a rich nightlife. Mecca saw a drunk man staggering against a house on the roadside, waving goodbye to a friend in the distance. His voice was already drunk and blurred. "Tomorrow, drink again tomorrow." The friend over there also had red cheeks and drank a lot. He shouted back, "Pete, don't be like today tomorrow. You got drunk after two glasses. You're such a wimp, ha ha ha." The passerby laughed and hurried away. "Someone got drunk here, which means the pub is not far away." Mecca smiled as the two parted. He walked a few steps, looked up and looked into the distance, and indeed found the plaque of Pig Head Bar. It should be almost 11 o'clock. He looked around and didn't see the short elf, so he pushed open the door and walked into the Hog's Head. Welcome. As soon as he entered the door, the blue-eyed boss spoke. He was a smiling old man with sweat on his face. He stretched out his sleeve to wipe the sweat and said enthusiastically, "What would you like, guest?" Mecca glanced at the people in the bar. The elf creature seemed not to have arrived yet. He said casually, "Two glasses of mead, thank you." "Okay." The boss began to pour and mix the drinks. Mecca found a corner to sit down, and soon the mead was served. He smiled and said thank you, which was greeted by the boss's more enthusiastic response. "Well, this wine is okay, very suitable for the elderly and children to drink." Mecca tasted the mead, which was mellow and mellow, without any spicy smell. Instead, it would taste sweet in the mouth, with a distinct honey taste. He tasted it quietly. Not long after, the door of the bar rang, and a short figure also wrapped in a robe looked around, but was a little confused, as if he didn't know what the person he had agreed to meet looked like. Mecca smiled and raised his hand, "Here." The short figure walked over, raised his head, and revealed half of his old and wrinkled face, which was the face of the elf. "Who are you?" it said in a hoarse voice. Mecca replied, "The person who wrote to you, Mr. Creature." The elf blushed and hesitated, as if he had never heard anyone call him an elf so politely, and it was an old elf who was about to die. "Don't call me that." It finally got out of the embarrassment, "I'm just a servant." Mecca ignored it, made an invitation gesture, and said politely, "Please sit down, Mr. Creature, the mead here is not bad, mellow and sweet, very suitable for those of us who don't drink much." Creature was at a loss, and after a while, he took a sip with curiosity, and his eyes widened. He had never drunk such a sweet thing. "Not bad." Mecca laughed at its reaction. He didn't say much, chatted for a few words, took out the letter from Principal Black, and got straight to the point. "The letter is here." Mecca handed the letter to Creature. Creature showed an excited expression, his face under the brim of his hat was flushed, he was a little out of control, his hands trembled and his voice became sharp and piercing. "Letter, letter, the old master's letter." The guests next to him looked at this scene in surprise, but soon their attention returned to the casual conversation at the wine table. Mecca drank the wine and watched Creature calm down from excitement. He then drank another big mouthful of mead and became restless, looking anxious to go back. "I can," Creature said embarrassedly, "I want to go back. I don't know if you—" Mecca smiled and stood up. "Of course, I'm leaving too. I'll pay for the wine. You can go back directly. Be careful on the road." Creature politely drank the mead and stood up excitedly. He took two steps and almost lost his balance. You can imagine how the letter made him feel. Mecca helped him and they parted ways after leaving the bar. Mecca looked at his figure going away and smiled. The letter has been delivered to Creature. When he returns to the ancestral home of the Black family, I can ask Headmaster Black for the reward. He was also inevitably happy. He strode around Hogsmeade Village at night. After half an hour, he turned into a bat and flew back to Hogwarts. Just as Mecca left, a strange man who was also covered by a robe came to Hogsmeade Village and walked towards the Hog's Head. The strange man with a robe covering his face exuded a strange smell. After he came to the Hog's Head, he stayed in the corner for a while, and finally a man dressed as a peddler came over. The peddler wearing a felt hat put a gray bag on the table, he smiled and said, "You are so lucky, my customer, this is the last mountain monster left here, and it is the youngest and strongest one, which is the best for guarding the house." The strange man opposite hummed and took the gray bag. He opened a gap, and the light from the bar shone in. He saw a hideous gray monster in the darkness raised its head, looked at him, and roared like a beast. "Very good." The strange man tightened his pocket, he took out a bag of money from his arms and threw it to the peddler. The merchant's eyes lit up, and after a chuckle, he lowered his head and counted the gold galleons under the table. After confirming that everything was correct, he picked up the wine glass on the table and drank it all. "This glass of wine is for you, my guest. Don't forget me next time you have business." The weirdo didn't respond, but nodded slightly and watched the merchant leave the Hog's Head. He raised his head and drank a sip of wine. In the dim light, he revealed a familiar pale face, which was Quirinus Quirrell. Professor Quirrell put down his wine glass, weighed the gray bag, and smiled. With this mountain giant, and some arrangements, the plan could be pushed forward. This time, as long as Snape was led away, he was sure to take the stone. He put away the gray bag, stood up and was about to leave, but suddenly stopped. He saw that the door of the bar was opened again. This time, the person who came in was unbelievably tall, and his head almost touched the ceiling of the bar. He was simply a little giant. Hagrid, the bar owner greeted with a smile, "What would you like today?" "Same old." Rubius Hagrid put his hands in the pockets of his moleskin coat and said in a muffled voice, "Bring me a barrel of brandy." "Oh no, two barrels." The bar owner bent down, picked up two small wooden barrels, and brought them to Hagrid. He took off the barrel lids, and inside was golden liquor with a strong aroma. The bar owner chatted with Hagrid for a few words, then went to the bar to mix drinks. Another customer came. Professor Quirrell watched this scene, motionless, and there was a voice in his head talking to him. "Rubo, Hagrid has many animals, even the ferocious eight-eyed spider in the Forbidden Forest." The hoarse voice said, "Do you think he knows the existence of the three-headed dog?" Quirrell was enlightened, his eyes turned, and he had an idea. He walked to Hagrid and sat down by himself. By the time the elf creature returned to the ancestral home of the Black family, it was already early in the morning. He was so excited that he showed no sign of fatigue and opened the letter symbolizing hope with trembling hands. The old elf creature unfolded the letter tremblingly. He just glanced at the beginning and burst into tears. "It's the old master's handwriting, it's the old master's handwriting." It knew that with its old master here, the Black family to which it had been loyal all its life could be saved. The letter is not very long and the handwriting is friendly. It says, "Creature, I'm sending this letter from the underworld. I need you to do something on my behalf to save the declining Black family. I already know the news about my great-great-grandson, Sirius. I have entrusted someone to help rescue him, but I need your constant attention. Regarding the disappearance of Sirius' brother Regulus, please write a letter in my name. Please come to my former Slytherin student for help. The address is. I made a lot of friends during my lifetime, and there were a lot of powerful people there, but I'm no longer alive, so I'm afraid these connections are no longer very useful. But I still have some methods left for you to use." Creature watched hungrily, weeping and wiping away. It was so excited that it crawled on the chair. The old master still has some connections left behind, but most of them are people he has benevolenced in the past and have reliable relationships. With these people here, as long as the old master sends a specific message, they will help the Black family get back on their feet and secretly protect Black's descendants. At the end of the letter, there was a blood-stained sentence. "This letter can save your life at a critical moment. After Sirius returns, leave the letter to him for safekeeping. Remember to keep it close to him and never take it off under any circumstances." Creature recited it repeatedly to make it memorable and not to forget such an important event. Its voice was trembling and sharp, echoing faintly in the historic ancestral house. In the darkness, a self-portrait hanging on the stairs suddenly opened its eyes. Hog's Head Bar. Hagrid looked at the strange man who came uninvited in front of him in surprise. He asked politely, "Who are you?" Professor Quirrell responded with a smile, "I just came here. I am a traveler from the south. I want to tell you about the magical animals around here. I am very interested in them." These words sounded like those rogue poachers, and Hagrid's face darkened. "You want to hunt them?" "No, no," Professor Quirrell waved his hand quickly. "I am a fan of magical animals. This trip is to find more magical animals, observe and understand their habits. I have absolutely no intention of imprisoning or killing them." Hagrid was dubious and stared at Quirrell's covered face. "You are dressed very strangely, you don't look like a good person." Professor Quirrell explained. "I got a strange disease during the trip. Herpes appeared on my face. The locals said it was contagious because I had to cover my face." Professor Quirrell spoke again, and his sincere attitude finally dispelled Hagrid's doubts. He pretended to be the same fan of magical animals as Hagrid, and the two of them talked about many topics related to magical animals. "Speaking of these large magical animals," Hagrid regretted, "I have raised many, including eight-eyed spiders, three-headed dogs. I originally wanted to raise another dragon, but dragons are too rare here, and I have never had the chance." Quote. Professor Quirrell's eyes lit up when he heard this. He said, "Oh," and laughed, "You want to raise a dragon? That's a coincidence. I happened to collect a dragon egg a few days ago and I still have it with me. Quote. He took out another light-colored bag from his arms and threw it in front of Hagrid. Hagrid caught it hurriedly. He glanced at Professor Quirrell and opened the bag after getting his approval. There was indeed a black egg inside, with mysterious raised lines on it, and it moved from time to time, as if it hadn't been long since it hatched. Are they really dragon eggs? Hagrid beamed. He had absolutely no resistance to these little creatures. Professor Quirrell smiled and said, "Can I still lie to you? It's useless for me to keep this dragon egg. I rarely raise such a big magical animal. I'm afraid I won't be able to raise it, so I just gave it to you." This, Hagrid was very torn. With his simple nature, he really liked the little creatures in dragon eggs, but he also knew that dragon eggs were rare and should not be taken away from others. He thought again and again and pushed his pocket back, "It's better to keep this dragon with you. If you don't know how to raise it, I can teach you." Quirrell's face was serious and he said displeased, "Ly, I said I would give this to you, what? You don't recognize me as your friend." Hagrid blushed and hesitated to explain that this was not the case. Quirrell used the excuse that he had to travel and didn't have time to take care of it on the way, so he finally let Hagrid accept the dragon egg. Hagrid was as excited as a child. He opened his pocket and observed it for a long time, then reluctantly put it away and clinked his glasses with Quirrell. At this time, someone was playing Pickle, which is a popular local card game. They were playing enthusiastically, so Quirrell suggested playing Pickle. The two drank and played cards. 2 hours later, Hagrid was red in the face, drunk, and started talking nonsense. Professor Quirrell tried a few words, knowing that he was unconscious. "Hagrid, do you know what the three-headed dog is afraid of?" Quirrell asked with a smile. He wanted to find a better way to deal with the three-headed dog. Although the nettles and sulfur powder from last time worked, as long as he touched the iron door leading to the secret passage, it would cause the three-headed dog to go crazy. He had no chance to open the door of the secret passage and enter. Hagrid lay on the table, heard Quirrell's words, and replied incoherently, I don't know." Quote. Professor Quirrell's face darkened when he heard this. Could it be that tonight's efforts were in vain? "But my furry," Hagrid burped, "it will fall asleep when it hears music, and it will scream no matter how hard it is, can't wake it up." Professor Quirrell smiled again. He ignored Hagrid, got up and left the Hog's Head bar, disappearing into the night. In the early morning night, everything is silent. Just when Professor Quirrell left the Pig's Head bar, Mecca, who was already asleep in the dormitory, suddenly shook his body and entered the dream space. The fire in the fireplace was burning, and the old man was no longer sitting at the table. He was standing in front of the portraits of the previous principals, seeming to be reminiscing. By the time Mecca Anders arrived, his body had gradually become transparent, and he got a go. "Thank you for your help, young man." He turned around and bowed to Mecca to thank him. Mecca was startled and quickly avoided his gift. "This is my honor, Principal Black. The letter has been taken away by creature. I think it should be safely returned to the ancestral home. I can feel it." The old man nodded in response. "There is a portrait of me in the ancestral house, which resonates with the method I left in the letter. I received this message immediately, so I asked you to come here from your sleep." Quote. Light spots flew up from his body, and his face gradually became broken, like scraps of paper flying around. He smiled and said, "I'm about to leave, and I want to give you something before I leave." "This is a deal." Mecca shook his head, "You don't owe me anything. The less you want it, the more I want to give it to you." The old man laughed, took out a golden quill from his arms, and threw it to Mecca. "Take it, this is the only thing I have left, although it's not precious, but I believe it will help you." The old man couldn't refuse at all. He seemed to suddenly give up resistance, and most of his body disappeared. The silver light spots in the sky were like heavy snow flying, which was very spectacular. "Principal Black," Mecca was surprised at how quickly he disappeared, but she had no choice but to watch him disappear. The old man's last face disappeared in the heavy snow, and his concerned voice became distant. "The Black family." Mikar held the light quill tightly, raised his hand to say goodbye, and said loudly, "Principal Black, thank you for your gift." The old man responded with laughter, and his voice echoed in the space. Soon, the entire house shattered and flew away in the wind. Mecca sat quietly alone in this gray wilderness. He waited for a while and saw a golden rain of light falling from the sky. The golden rain fell on his face, which was ice cold. He knew that Principal Black's legacy was coming. Obtain the legacy of Phineas Nigellus Black, the rune of the transformation curse. This is a rune that can be carved and hidden in the body. After many years of cultivation by Phineas, this rune has absorbed abundant spiritual power and can combine with the host, making the rune perfectly integrated into the body. It's like the human body has an extra organ. When Mecca was reading these words, bloodlines first appeared on his face, spreading from the center of his eyebrows, and soon spread all over his body, with red light flashing. He lowered his head, rolled up his sleeves, saw the exquisite and mysterious lines on his hands and arms, and marveled at the skillful workmanship of the Black family. Mecca soon felt the heat, as if there was a furnace hidden in his body. Sweat dripped from his forehead, and the clothes on his body were quickly soaked. A physical transformation was underway. This transformation went deep into the body, red light overflowed from the body, the blood all over the body boiled, the blood vessels seemed to be burning, and the body was already red with heat. He felt an unusual burning pain on the back of his right hand. When he lowered his head, he saw that the blood traces of the vampire were so bright red that they actually combined with the blood lines of the runes to form a lifelike bloody rose. This change involved blood, and he vaguely felt that the vampire's natural animagus seemed to have undergone some kind of change. The blood lines on his body glowed brighter, and Mecca quickly closed his eyes. He gritted his teeth and persisted. The burning pain on the back of his right hand spread to his whole body. It was really painful. For a while, the pain was so severe that his teeth were about to break, but he still held back and did not yell out because he was afraid that he would also scream out in his sleep. After this pain, the heat in his body subsided, and he soon realized that the changes were ending. Soon, the sweat stopped and the bloodlines completely faded away. Mecca Anders wiped away the remaining sweat stains on his forehead. He took a deep breath and felt that the air in this space was so fresh. What exactly happened to your body? Only then did Mecca have the intention to observe his body. The first thing he discovered was that his mental power had greatly increased, probably to nearly double its original size. This was due to the absorption of the residual mental power hidden in the runes. With the blessing of greatly increased mental power, his eyes and ears felt clear, his thoughts had never been so clear, and he could think of things much faster. Mecca looks happy, his mental strength increases, and his magic talent will also be improved accordingly. Learning magic will not be as difficult as before. The most important change is probably the animagus. Mecca clearly felt that the runes of the transformation curse were carved into his body, causing a strong reaction from the animagus. He closed his eyes slightly, as if he saw the shadow of a bat emerging from his body. Its body is the same as before, but its wings have become larger, and there are light lines on the wings. Even without the transformation, Mecca can sense that the wings of the bat body have become majestic and powerful, with the potential of an eagle. This is the upper limit of animagus being broken. Mecca was surprised. Generally speaking, animagus does not grow. What it was like at the beginning is what it will be like later. It almost remains unchanged. But the combination of the runes of the transformation curse and the blood of vampires, one is the secret of an ancient family, and the other is the lifelong effort of a talented transformation wizard. The combination of the two actually caused the animagus to mutate. There is the possibility of further growth. Mecca wondered if animagus continued to grow, would it be possible to break through the boundaries in the future, give birth to supernatural beings, and become a magical animal? Mecca was about to continue exploring when he suddenly heard the sound of wind in his ears and a storm above his head. It's time to wake up. He knew at once that the dream was coming to an end, and that the space was beginning to fall apart. Waking up from bed, Mecca opened the quilt and was suddenly attracted by the bloody rose mark on the back of her hand. It was no longer so bright red, but it still looked so exquisite and lifelike. The blood fetus is also different from before. It seems that this combination has really caused an incredible change. Mecca touched this bloody mark and felt the changes in it. The blood fetus creates a desire for more blood. In other words, originally the blood fetus could only absorb blood of the same origin as the vampire, but now it is different. The range of blood it can absorb has increased. But I'm afraid I have to test the specific blood it can absorb. Mecca failed to get more information from the blood fetus. Ask the Weasley twins if they have any magical animal blood. Let's use it as a test. It will also activate more vampire blood. He put on Gryffindor's standard robes, looked up and saw that it was already noon, and his stomach growled at the right time. Let's go eat first. Mecca smiled and walked out of the dormitory. In the auditorium, Mecca and Harry were sitting together eating. Seeing that there was no one around, Hermione suddenly mentioned the last encounter in the abandoned classroom. Tell me, why is that three-headed dog in that abandoned classroom? Hermione frowned. This thing is so strange. The three-headed dog is a very dangerous magical animal. How could the professors let it in? She subconsciously looked at Mecca, because he had walked freely in that classroom and might have seen something. But Mecca shook his head. I only saw the three-headed dog in that classroom. The rest of the place was too dark to observe. Someone must have smuggled it in. Ron guessed casually while eating fish and chips. Unlikely. Hermione shook her head, denying this guess. Even if the professors didn't notice it entering the school, they would definitely know of its existence after the big noise that night. As a result, no news has come out until now. I think this may be the professor's deliberate arrangement. It was them. Let the three-headed dog stay there. Deliberately arranged. Ron was surprised. No way, the three-headed dog is so dangerous, if someone is eaten by it. Hermione quickly had more associations. Yes, what are you doing by leaving it there despite knowing the danger? Are you protecting something precious? When Harry heard this, he suddenly thought of something. He talked about an incident before the start of school. Before I came to Hogwarts, Hagrid and I went to Gringotts. Does Mecca know about this? Mecca nodded. Harry almost fell down, but he helped him. The two got to know each other, and he replied. Well, that was the first time we met. That day, we entered the innermost level of Gringotts. Hagrid took a crystal stone there. He said it was commissioned by Professor Dumbledore. Harry thought, that stone, Hagrid, it is said to be a very precious thing, the work of a master alchemist. Crystal stone. Hermione was surprised. She quickly connected two things. It was really possible that this was something that the three-headed dog was guarding. Even Professor Dumbledore values it so much, and it is the work of a master alchemist. So, is it really possible that this three-headed dog is guarding this stone? Hermione was very excited, feeling that she had guessed something extraordinary, but she quickly frowned. But what exactly is this stone? And whose work is it? Ron lowered his head and continued to eat the food on his plate. He was not interested in using his brain. Harry was very interested, but he couldn't figure out what the stone could be. Finally, seeing that the food was getting cold, Mecca made a suggestion. You have to go to the library to find the answer to this kind of thing. Now let's eat first. After coming out of the auditorium, they separated. Hermione and Harry were going to the library to find the answer. Ron refused to go, so he took the first step. Mecca didn't go either. He went back to the Gryffindor dormitory to find the Weasley twins on the pretext that he had something to do. Soon he completed a deal with the Weasley twins and harvested the blood of several magical animals, including flobber caterpillars, horned beasts, and goblins known as garden pests. The money on his body was a little less, and Mecca felt a pain in his body. Fortunately, these magical animals were relatively common, so the blood was not particularly expensive and could still be afforded. Back in his dormitory, Mecca began to tinker with the blood. First, some blood of the flobber caterpillar. Mecca poured the bottle containing the blood of the flobber caterpillar, green blood dripped on the back of his hand, and a red light flashed. Mecca was waiting for further changes, but saw that the blood was rejected, and green blood dripped from the back of his hand. It slipped and fell to the ground. He had no time to catch it and felt distressed, as a silver coin just gone. Mecca tried the horned beast's blood again. This bright red blood had gray dots hidden in it, like grains of sand. The blood fell on the back of his hand, but it still didn't work. He was so angry that he wanted to yell, but he was afraid of attracting the attention of people outside the dormitory, so he held back. Just as Mecca dripped the goblin blood, the mark on the back of his hand returned to its bright red appearance, as if a bloody rose bloomed, swallowing up the goblin blood bit by bit. Soon, Mecca showed a surprised expression. He felt that with the absorption of goblin blood, his proficiency in transformation-related spells was actually improving. What's going on? Mecca Anders observed the changes in his body and soon understood what was going on. This was something called magic will, taking effect. In the runes of the Transfiguration spell, there is not only mental power, but also the residual magic will of Principal Black. He was surprised. This was an unexpected surprise. Magic will is the residue after casting a spell. This kind of thing is colorless and invisible. It is hard to find. If it can be purified, it can be absorbed into the body and become the nutrient of the spell. The blood fetus is really a good thing. Mecha knew that this was because the blood fetus played a filtering role, sucking out the magic will in the runes as impurities, making the magic will visible and storing it again. What's more, the blood fetus can just absorb blood as energy to purify the magic will, making it harmless and safe for people to absorb. Mecha didn't expect that. He originally thought that the spell was too slow to improve and lacked the means of direct confrontation, but he didn't expect to be sent a sleepy pillow. But his face soon fell. This required the blood of magical animals to charge, so how much blood would it cost? How much will it cost to buy blood? It looks like we're going to go bankrupt. Mecha was both happy and worried. He couldn't wait to be rated as a magic apprentice, so that he could make potions in large quantities and make a lot of money. It's not that he hadn't thought about the three-headed dog, but drawing blood from the three-headed dog can only be done occasionally. If you draw too much blood from the three-headed dog will wake up even if it falls asleep, right? What's more, this three-headed dog is an asset of Hogwarts. If it is damaged by blood, someone will definitely come to the door. I don't know if there is any information from Professor Snape. When will the rating assessment start? Mecha thought about buying a large amount of magical animal blood next, and couldn't help missing Snape. When Mecha found the Weasley twins again, the two were fighting because of the uneven distribution, from the head of the bed to the foot of the bed, but a closer look showed that the two were tickling each other. Mecha wanted to laugh, so he coughed and attracted the attention of the two. George pulled his clothes that were revealing and got up from the ground. He snorted coldly. Fred, I'll let you go this time. Me too. Fred also turned his head away, disdainful. But when he turned his head to look at Mecha, he looked like he saw the god of wealth. He said happily. How is the quality of the blood of the magical animals I just bought? Is it very good? I bought it, George emphasized. Fred didn't even look at him and asked, Mecha, do you want blood this time? Mecha smiled and nodded. I only want the goblins, not the other two. How much do you want? Fred smiled. I'm not bragging, I can find you as much as you want. What does it have to do with you? I bought it, George refuted, and said to Mecha enthusiastically. Mecha, how much do you want? I will send it to you tomorrow. I may want a little too much. Mecha thought. How much can you find in a short time? Fred didn't say anything this time. He looked at George and waited for him to speak. You want a lot, it's good to have a lot. George's eyes lit up. I can find you 20 ounces today, is it enough? Mecha thought that the 1 ounce of goblin blood in the morning was quickly consumed and did not improve the spell much, so he shook his head. Not enough, but take as much as you can first. He thought about it and continued. The rest of the blood, 1 ounce at a time, do the test first, and if it can be purchased together. George quickly agreed. He thought about making a lot of money, and he was overjoyed. Fred was also happy, but he had doubts. Mecha, you buy so much blood of magical animals, what are you going to do? Making potions. Mecha responded casually. You know, practicing potions consumes a lot of materials. Then why only buy blood? Fred was about to further express his doubts. George slapped him into the corner and scolded him. Just provide what the customer wants, why ask so many questions? Do you want to be a potion master? Mecha was amused. These are two funny people. After a few people chatted for a while, George ran first and brought some blood, saying that the rest would be delivered tomorrow, and more would have to wait, maybe some every day. After Mecha finished eating snacks, he took away a dark bag with satisfaction, which was full of blood of magical animals. In the following days, Mecha spent the rest of his time on improving his spell level except for eating, sleeping and attending classes. He spent a lot of money, almost draining his pockets, and the improvement he got was also huge, which was simply unimaginable to ordinary people. Feeling that his proficiency was improving at a rocket-like speed every day, Mecha felt that the happiness was indescribable to others. He could feel this happiness until his magic will was exhausted. But staying in the dormitory all the time was not good. Micah had to quietly experience the knowledge and spell experience he suddenly gained, which inevitably made him mentally exhausted. So Micah came out of the dormitory and wanted to go outside to see the sun, relax in the library, and see if Hermione had found the origin of the stone. When passing by Professor Snape's office, Mecca peeked in. He still hadn't gotten the specific time for the Magic Apprentice rating assessment. Unexpectedly, when he peeked in, a voice came from inside. "Come in, Anders." Professor Snape saw him. Mecca pushed the door open and walked in. Professor Snape was drinking coffee. He politely asked Mecca to have a cup as well. Mecca was not polite and took the opportunity to get a cup of coffee with a cloud-like texture. It tasted good. Some special magic ingredients were added. "Really good." Mecca drank a few sips and couldn't help but praise, "Professor, you have really good taste." Professor Snape smiled. "You came here to ask about the rating assessment?" Mecca nodded and responded. "Yes, I have been waiting for the rating assessment, but I don't know if the specific time is out." Professor Snape took out a relevant document and handed it to Mecca. He said, "The reply from the Magic Potion Guild arrived last night, and I just received it. The time is set for November 3rd, which is the third day after Halloween." Mecca nodded. He also saw it from the document. "Do I need to make any preparations?" Mecca asked. He didn't want any accidents to happen that day, otherwise his pockets would be empty and he would be completely in trouble. "Still the same ones," Professor Snape said. "Just master the methods of making potions in the book I gave you and keep a high success rate. I believe you can do it." Mecca was also confident in this. His talent for potions combined with his sense of vitality made him invincible. He was simply a natural potion master. Professor Snape thought and added, "There may be a few people coming from outside to take the test with you. You must remain calm and composed as usual and don't be affected."
"I will," Mecca replied. "That's all. Go and do your thing. Don't fall behind in potion practice," Snape said halfway, and suddenly his voice became cold. "Who is outside?"
A figure hurried away from the window, as if passing by. "On the third day after Halloween, the people from the Potions Guild will come." Professor Quirrell walked hurriedly. He hadn't received the document yet. He just passed by Snape and happened to hear it. He looked unhappy and felt urgent. The plan had to be advanced. "If I can get the stone before the Potion Guild arrives, everything will be fine. It doesn't matter whether they come or not. I can leave at any time. But I'm afraid of encountering the same accidents as before. I always feel unlucky recently. There are people who are against me everywhere." Professor Quirrell was depressed. He felt that everything was not going well. He had to leave a backup plan for himself. "Why don't we get rid of the people who will attract the Potion Guild?" His expression turned cold. With this idea, the people from the Potion Guild would not come, which could save a lot of trouble. Professor Quirrell came to a secret place with urgency and released the mountain giant monster bot from the traveling merchant. Looking at the tall, imposing and ferocious monster in front of him, he let out a beast-like roar and smiled. "Fortunately, I changed my mind for a while and did not go to the Forbidden Forest to capture the giant monster. Instead, I asked the traveling merchant to find a higher quality one. This giant monster is obviously different from ordinary giant monsters. With it, the plan will go much more smoothly." Quirrell took out his wand and pointed it at the troll to tame him. The huge and hard mountain monster's eyes flickered. He was actually smart. When he saw Quirrell pointing his wand at him, it quickly retreated, its eyes fierce, its teeth bared, and it looked like a wild wolf knowing how to advance and retreat. What a beast! Seeing that it was about to confront him, Quirrell smiled instead of being angry. He is indeed the leader of the mountain trolls. He is smarter than ordinary trolls and can be called cunning. He was satisfied that this was what he asked the traveling merchant. With wisdom, the troll would be far more difficult to deal with than before. Quirrell walked towards it, and the giant monster waved its ferocious mace. The fierce wind sounded. He wanted to scare Quirrell, so he swung the club towards the ground. At this moment, it actually made a hole in the ground with a spider web. There are dense cracks in the shape. There's something wrong with the power of this giant monster. Quirrell was also surprised. This power was much higher than that of ordinary giant monsters. Any wizard would die if he was hit in the head by this stick. Quirrell used a magic spell to disarm the giant monster's mace. When the mace was released,
The giant monster's eyes were surprised. He quickly leaned over and escaped, getting down on all fours. The huge body was so strong and powerful, as fast as a wild animal pouncing on food. It's impossible to react. The speed is also faster than ordinary trolls. Quirrell did not expect that the mountain troll monster he acquired this time was actually a troll leader who had improved in all aspects. Not only did his intelligence meet his requirements, but the rest of his strength and speed were different. All items are beyond ordinary giant monsters. It seems like this giant monster can bring bigger surprises to the people at Hogwarts. Quirrell couldn't restrain his excitement and continued to use magic spells to tame the troll, hoping to tame it before Halloween. Only in this way can it work for itself and become an indispensable part of the plan. The evening sun is setting, and the horizon is gradually blocking its outline. The dusk was receding, and the sky was getting dark. In the Gryffindor dormitory, Mecca was undergoing a new round of blood absorption. The bloody rose mark on the back of her hand was as scarlet as blood, which looked particularly dazzling in the dim room. The blood of the Acromantula can actually be absorbed by the blood fetus. Mecca smiled, watching the mark on the back of his hand absorb the blood of the giant eight-legged spider bit by bit, and he recorded the name of this creature on the paper. There are currently a variety of magical animals recorded on it, including goblins, dragon toads, acromantic spiders, etc. They can all become nutrients and energy for the blood fetus, which can be used to purify the magical will. After the blood of all the magical animals was exhausted, he put down the pen and paper to end today's test, and touched the space in his mind to check the progress of the spell these days. Mecca Anders, Potion Making Talent, Advanced. Potion Equipment Usage Level, 20 years. Mental Power Level, Level 38. Animagus, Bat, Magic, Level 7 Transformation Spell, Level 7 Transfiguration Spell, Level 7 Human Appearance Spell, Level 7 Color Changing Spell, Level 7 Restoration Spell, Level 7 Bird Summoning Spell. I've made huge progress these days, it's almost like a dream. Mecca was delighted to see it. If it was a dream, he hoped that the dream would last longer and not wake up too soon. But let's get here today. Mecca was already very tired. He lay on the chair, feeling that his brain was overused and he couldn't concentrate. He needed to rest and wait for the Weasley twins to deliver the goods again tomorrow before continuing to fight. I've made a new discovery. Mecca had just dozed off for a while when Harry came back. He opened the door to the dormitory, feeling a little excited. Hermione has found new clues. It is expected that the origin of the stone will be confirmed soon. Mecca was surprised, found a new clue so quickly. How did you find it? He was very tired and asked casually while lying on the chair. Ron followed Harry, and he was a little proud. I found it from the card hidden in the snacks. It can be said that I provided the clue. It turned out that Hermione found a card from the packaging of Ron's snacks, which introduced a famous alchemist in the 14th century. This gave her inspiration and reminded her of the books she had read in the past. Harry added, Hermione said that this alchemist named Nick Flamel once set off a wave of immortality in the 15th century. Some people say that he lives to this day, and some even speculate that he can live forever. Benefit from a stone. Hermione believed that stones, alchemist masters, and even top wizards like Professor Dumbledore valued them so much. One coincidence was a coincidence, and multiple coincidences might be facts. She also speculated, Harry said, the story about Gringotts being broken into by Hagrid when he first entered school should also be related to this stone. Someone is thinking about this stone, and the purpose may be related to immortality. Mecca nodded. Hermione's mind was indeed working well. He asked, where's Hermione? Didn't she come back with you? She's still in the library. Ron replied, lying on the bed, I think she's also crazy. She can stay in that place all day. Harry explained, Hermione wants to find more information about Nick Flamel in the library. She wants to thoroughly confirm that this stone comes from Nick Flamel, and it is the stone related to immortality. Mecca smiled, that was really her style. A few people chatted and went to the auditorium to have a meal. They talked about it until late at night, and fell asleep completely from exhaustion. This is a new batch of blood, 13 ounces in total. The next day, George Weasley sent the blood early in the morning. He settled with Mecca, and Mecca happily gave the money to him. The Weasley twins were indeed good at business. They purchased the blood from who knows where, and the price was actually cheaper than the shops in Hogsmeade. Hey, after collecting the money, George didn't leave. He asked, "Didn't you ask me to buy some interesting old things before?" Mecca was about to go back to the dormitory when he turned around in surprise. "What? Do you have one here?" George chuckled. "Yes, I collected something from a senior student yesterday. I thought you might like it." He took out an old medal from his pocket. The medal was golden, with some chips on the edges and traces of fire in the middle. He whispered, "According to your request, this thing is related to the dead. This medal is a duelist medal. Its owner was a duelist. He won 3 gold medals in a row in the Magic Duel Arena." Quote, "So powerful," Mecca was surprised. He knew very well what it meant to win 3 gold medals in a magic duel. The contestants in the duel competition came from all over the magic world and were almost all the best among wizards. And to be the winner among these outstanding ones, their strength must be extraordinary. "His owner is no longer alive?" Nikar asked. George nodded and whispered, "This duelist died together with his enemies, but I heard that he had more than one enemy. All of them were extremely vicious dark wizards, and they all appeared on Azkaban's list." "How do you know?" Mecca was surprised. "This is too detailed. Is there any witness to such a dangerous scene?" George chuckled and said, "I heard it from the cellar." Mecca groaned. "Is the cellar a member of his family?" George shook his head. "He also heard it from the previous cellar." Mecca suddenly had a dark look on his face. He believed it was just hearsay. This medal had changed hands several times, so it might not be true. He received the duelist medal, and a tall and thin figure flashed in his mind, which triggered the space in his mind. After George left, Mecca put away the duelist medal and walked out of the dormitory. There were yellow jack-o'-lanterns and tall scarecrows placed in the corner in preparation for Halloween. Then he suddenly realized, it turns out time flies by so fast, Halloween is coming. After receiving the duelist badge, Mecca Anders tried to enter the space in his brain that day. But the process of the magic will integrating into his body seemed to affect his brain, and he couldn't even dream, which made him look regretful, and he could only temporarily put away the duelist badge. What a pity. Mecca was originally looking forward to what kind of legacy a duelist with such an honor would bring. He guessed that there might be a chance to gain some enemy skills and experience from this duelist, which was what he was most looking forward to at the moment. Since the space in his brain could not be accessed for the time being, Mecca could only focus on the magic will in front of him and absorb all the magic will in the blood fetus and completely transform it into strength. The blood fetus mark turned bright red, and Mecca could clearly feel that most of the magic will inside had been consumed and completely transformed into the proficiency of the spell. In his mind, relevant knowledge or experience in using spells would pop up from time to time. As time passed, he absorbed and comprehended these thoroughly, and the level of the spell was improved again. Soon, the blood of the magical animals was consumed, and there was no money left. Due to the shortage of blood of magical animals, the purification and absorption of the magic will was interrupted. This time, an unexpected situation occurred during the interruption, just like a withdrawal reaction. The last bit of magic will remained in the body, making trouble. Mecca occasionally felt a headache and his memory was affected. Soon, he discovered a hateful fact. The level of the spell is actually showing signs of regression. Mecca was heartbroken. This was a waste of so many gold galleons and silver sickles he invested. He soon realized that he had to absorb the last magic will as soon as possible, otherwise the spell would really drop in level. Its proficiency was already slowly regressing. In this trouble, Halloween arrived. A blinking pumpkin lantern was hung at the door of the auditorium. A headless ghost floated by and revealed a transparent body in front of the lantern. It held its head, smiled at the crowd, bowed, and suddenly disappeared. This was the headless knight known to everyone in Hogwarts. In the hall, the lights were bright, people and ghosts were having fun together. After Professor Dumbledore's speech, the students happily had their meal under the lights. Mecca was immersed in the food, eating steak slowly and leisurely. The food on the table was rich, much richer than before, mostly meat, emitting an attractive oily sheen under the light, with a translucent amber color. Harry suddenly asked Hermione a question. He whispered, "Have you found all the information about Nick Flamel?" Hermione shook her head. She mentioned her efforts in the library, a little discouraged. In the library, Nick Flamel's information seems to be blocked. It can't be found at all, let alone the content related to the stone. Harry was surprised. He glanced at the professors in the distance, quickly retracted his gaze, and lowered his voice. Could it be that Professor Dumbledore had prepared it in advance? The purpose is to prevent us from knowing the secret behind the three-headed dog. Hermione shook her head. She didn't know if there was this reason, she had another guess. It may also be that the stone is too eye-catching. After all, it is related to the secret of immortality. If someone knows it, it is estimated that they will try their best to get it. Several people stopped talking tacitly, and a ghost floated over. It was the Headless Knight Nick. He put on the head in his hand and raised his glass to signal several people. When Ron saw him doing etiquette, his head fell off again and he laughed out loud, "This ghost is really interesting." The ghost floated away, and Mecca was drinking mellow orange juice to relieve the greasiness. Hermione hesitated, touched Mecca's arm, and asked aloud. She knew that Mecca often went to Professor Snape's place and wanted to know when Snape was not in the office. Mecca was puzzled and put down the orange juice in his hand. "Why are you asking this?" Hermione looked around. There was a lot of noise around. Everyone was talking about their own things and no one cared about them. She said quietly, "I want to find a chance to go to the restricted book area. There should be information about Nick Flamel there, but Professor Snape's office is on that must-pass road." Mecca frowned. Hermione actually had this idea. The restricted book area is forbidden by professors for students to go there. There are too many things that students should not see, or forbidden spells, or knowledge that is not allowed to be spread. If you want to go there, you have to risk being criticized or even expelled. It's hard to say. Mecca told the truth. Professor Snape's whereabouts were uncertain and it was hard to tell his schedule. Sometimes he was in the office for most of the day, and sometimes he was not seen there all day. Harry heard it from the side. He was surprised and worried. "Hermione, if we are caught, the school's punishment will probably be very severe." Hermione was unhappy. "It's a pity. If I could go to the restricted book area, some doubts in my heart would be completely solved." Mecca smiled. She was in the spirit of breaking the casserole to get to the bottom of it. No wonder she answered questions so sharply in class. It turned out that the foundation of the academic master was here. He saw that Hermione didn't speak again. He was picking up the glass of orange juice again. Suddenly, there was a loud bang. He was startled. The orange juice in his hand shook violently in the glass, and the overflowing juice spilled on his thumb. Everyone was scared and focused their eyes on the door of the auditorium. "It's over," Professor Quirrell shouted in panic. He pushed open the door of the auditorium and staggered in, with bright red blood on his head. Professor Quirrell pointed outside the door and said in panic, "The troll came in, I didn't stop it, hurry up, hurry up." Seeing Quirrell almost out of breath, Professor Dumbledore stood up and said, "Don't worry, Professor Quirrell, your head is still bleeding, are you okay now?" Blood. Professor Quirrell was stunned for a moment. He reached out and touched the top of his head, looked down, his hands were already covered with shocking blood. He screamed in fear, his eyes rolled back, and he fainted directly. This change directly ignited the panic in the entire auditorium, and some people followed suit and shouted in panic. Even the professor was knocked down. How could they guarantee their own safety? The crowd was about to riot, and Mecca saw Ron panicking and trying to escape, but he was pulled back by him. "Quiet," Professor Dumbledore's voice calmed everyone at once. His voice was old but steady, just like his tall body, which made people feel reliable. He looked at Professor McGonagall. Professor McGonagall got his signal. She stood up and said to the students present, "Everyone leave the hall and return to the dormitory. Do not walk around. The prefects of each grade will supervise along the way. Those who violate the rules will be recorded and severely punished afterwards." She looked at all the professors at the same table and said seriously, "Madam Pomfrey, you will take people to send Professor Quirrell to the school hospital for treatment. Professor Snape, you are responsible for sending students to the dormitory safely and maintaining the safety of the scene. The rest of the professors will act separately and find the traces of the troll as soon as possible to stop its destructive behavior." Under Professor McGonagall's arrangement, the scene was in order. The students lined up to leave in anxiety, and the professors left from the front door first to track the troll that suddenly broke in. Mecca walked behind the crowd and saw Professor Snape following the team. His eyes fell back on the unconscious Professor Quirrell. Madame Pomfrey supported him and was going to send him to the school hospital. In the noisy and chaotic crowd, his fingers suddenly moved, and soon stopped, making people feel that it seemed to be an illusion. The students lined up in a rough team and were heading towards the dormitory. The students' anxiety turned into whispers. The Gryffindor prefect was leading the team in front, but Harry suddenly called Ron. Mecca and Hermione are missing. Missing. Ron was stunned and looked around. Sure enough, there was no trace of the two. He was also shocked. The situation is so chaotic now, where can they run to? Harry's face was not good. He thought of a place that Hermione mentioned at the banquet. He guessed that Hermione said that she wanted to go to the restricted area. The situation was very chaotic now, but it was the best opportunity to go to the restricted area because the professors had no time to pay attention to it. And Mecca, he guessed that he was worried about Hermione, so he went with her. Restricted area. Harry took a deep breath. Aw. Let's go. Harry took Ron's hand and quietly left the crowd. Let's run faster. We have to find them before the Gryffindor prefects and professors find out. Outside the school hospital, a black bat hung on the treetops, its eyes were sharp, staring at the wards in the school hospital. A figure quietly stood up and left the school hospital without anyone knowing. He strode away, and the direction he left was exactly the abandoned classroom where the three-headed dog was locked up. Professor Quirrell is going to the abandoned classroom again. Mecca took a deep breath. This was an adventure. He had no money on him. He wanted to take advantage of the chaos to harvest another wave of three-headed dog's blood, charge the blood fetus, and completely absorb the last magic will. He had a firm look in his eyes. He wanted to prevent the spell level from regressing and not allow his money to be wasted. The crowd in the distance was bustling and gathered into a long dragon, with a few lights mixed in. Someone was holding an oil lamp to illuminate the way ahead, but Professor Quirrell was going in the opposite direction of the students. He was alone, hiding in the shadows, and was silent. A black bat flew in the air, and his dark eyes took in everything. After Professor Quirrell passed a majestic old tree, he stayed for a while, and when he came out again, he had changed into a strange face. He put on a black robe, covering his rough new face under the robe, and his pace suddenly accelerated. He had to hurry up and rush to the abandoned classroom while the chaos was going on. Very alert, Mecca Anders praised this vest-wearing behavior, and the bat flapped its wings and followed. The power of these wings has really become much stronger. Mecca was surprised. He felt that his wings were majestic, flying in the air, almost like an eagle, and the speed was actually increased so much with just a slight flap of the wings. He felt that he was going too fast, so in order not to be noticed by Quirrell, he slowed down again. I don't know when I can grow again. Therefore, Mecca felt that his animagus might be different from the animagus of ordinary wizards. Now the wings of bats have the potential of eagles, so if they grow again, they may be able to approach or even catch up with those magical animals. He saw Professor Quirrell's figure suddenly disappear, and there was a residual smell of garlic leaving quickly. This was because he cast the disillusionment charm to become invisible. He quickly tightened his attention and caught up. In front of the abandoned classroom, Professor Quirrell, who had rushed all the way, stopped in front of the door. He touched the pocket under the lining and smiled. This time he came prepared, and all plans were going smoothly. Quirinus. A hoarse voice suddenly came from behind him. The more it is at this time, the more we cannot let down our guard. Professor Quirrell put away his smile and whispered, I know, master. He pointed his wand and clicked. The rusty door lock opened. He pushed open the heavy door, strode in, and disappeared into the darkness. Keep your distance this time. The bat hanging on the corridor turned its dark head. Mecca was very cautious. He couldn't be discovered by the hoarse voice again. He came to fish in troubled waters this time, not to die. He waited for the footsteps to fade away. A flapping wing turned into a shadow from the far end of the corridor. Just as it was about to fly into the door, it suddenly froze. It stopped flying and its feet were pressed against the cold ceiling outside the door. Thanks to the mutant sense of smell brought by vampire blood, The smell of garlic that had been cleaned up had become very faint, but it could still smell it. It didn't move. It was near the door. Mecca's heart was pounding. Was he discovered? Are we going to stage another great escape? In the darkness, there was silence. No one inside or outside the door moved, and a game of courage and patience was quietly going on. Time seemed to stop at this moment, and a suffocating atmosphere spread in the darkness. Suddenly, meow, a shrill cat cry sounded slowly. It was Filch's cat. It had been sleeping in the shadow in the corner, and no one noticed it. After waking up, it stretched and slowly walked outside the door. At this time, a voice finally came from inside the door. "It's a cat, master." It was Quirrell's voice. "Maybe I sensed it wrongly." The hoarse voice said, "I always feel that there is a pair of eyes watching us. It seems that I have been sleeping for too long and my senses have become dull." Quirrell did not answer. He took a step forward. "Quirinus, you should be more cautious because of this," the hoarse voice said indifferently. "Don't let me down again." Kiluo stopped again and lowered his voice. "I will, master." The footsteps and the smell faded away together, and Micah breathed a sigh of relief. This time he really left. Not bad. Micah knew that if it weren't for his unique vitality sense, and his overly sensitive to the smell of herbs and biological materials, he would probably not be able to escape this time. Of course, there are other factors. "This cat does look handsome today," Micah praised silently. It twisted its dark head and looked at the skinny cat under its feet. It never felt that this cat was so well proportioned and had the potential to be white and beautiful. It was worthy of being called Mrs. Loris's cat. Micah stayed quietly for a while, and fluttered into the door again, silently. Professor Quirrell walked in the darkness. He could hear the snoring of the beast in his ears. It was so clear that he did not stop and continued to walk deeper, approaching the sound. At some point, the snoring disappeared. Quirrell stopped and looked up with a solemn expression. The three-headed dog might have woken up. Its senses were too sharp. In the darkness above his head, a huge lantern suddenly bloomed, and its terrifying eyes stared at the ant under his feet. The hell three-headed dog stood up. Its body was huge, and there was a huge sound when it stood up. There was a sound of water flowing in the darkness. It was the smelly saliva flowing from the corners of the three-headed dog's mouth. Three-headed dog. Professor Quirrell's expression was tense. The threat emanating from it was too great. No matter how many times he saw it, he always felt creepy. He clenched the wand in his hand, and the other hand was freed to grope in his arms. The three-headed dog walked over, its huge paws stepping on the ground. It felt like an earthquake. It seemed to be still growing, and its size was even bigger than the last time I saw it. Three ferocious heads drooped, spewing out hot and smelly breath. The fangs in the bloody mouths were scary white, like human bones. Professor Quirrell's hair stood up. He quickly took out a light-colored pocket from his arms, and in this palm-sized pocket, he actually took out a golden harp the size of a human head. He placed the harp on the ground and stretched out his wand to aim at the strings on the harp. Roar! The three-headed dog's eyes fell on Quirrell, and it was about to get close to his body, sniffing the smell of food with its nostrils. The dripping saliva flowed on the ground, surrounded Quirrell, and formed a green pool under Quirrell's feet. Quirrell felt that his feet had sunk into the sticky liquid, and the cold feeling surged from the soles of his feet, stimulating his spirit. He whispered to the harp at a rapid speed. "Automachi, pagiers." The white light flashed like lightning. On the golden harp, the strings were rustling, and a pair of invisible hands were playing music. The melodious sound of the harp seemed to blow from the lake. The three-headed dog's head drooped, and a trace of trance flashed across it, and it was stagnant in place. "It really works." Kiluo breathed a sigh of relief and quietly loosened his hand in his pocket. Some golden and white powder slipped out. This was the nettle powder and sulfur he prepared, but it seemed unnecessary now. He still stared at the three-headed dog. The sound of the harp was soft and ethereal, as if there was a clear spring flowing in the mountains, which soothed people's hearts. The three-headed dog's huge eyes were half open and half closed, and the eyelids fought. After a while, they finally closed completely. The huge body lay on the ground, with its head leaning on its front paws, and its expression was peaceful and tranquil, as if it had fallen into a deep sleep and was completely hypnotized. "We have to speed up next." Quirrell did not forget that although the chaos outside was still going on, it would eventually calm down. He didn't have much time, so he had to speed up and grab the coveted stone. He walked quickly to the iron door leading to the underground secret passage, pointed his wand, and the heavy chain quickly fell off and fell to the ground. Finally, with a clang, the iron door opened completely, revealing a dark passage that seemed to be bottomless. Quirrell's face showed joy. He looked back at the three-headed dog and saw that it was still sleeping peacefully, so he turned around and walked into the corridor. In the darkness, a black bat landed lightly on the ground, and the shadow on the ground quickly expanded and shrank and struggled. A figure in a black robe walked up to the three-headed dog. "Sleep very soundly, but you will sleep well, you will sleep well." Mecca smiled. He took out the golden blood-drawing syringe from his bosom, and from the bulging pockets on both sides of his body, he took out 5 empty potion bottles and filled them all at once. "I'm sorry, Hagrid's hair." Mecca stroked the fur of the three-headed dog. He had no choice. If he didn't do it, the money would be wasted. He couldn't just watch the spell level and spend money to increase it, and now watch it fall, right? Weighing the pros and cons, he could only wrong the three-headed dog. But with such a strong body, 5 bottles are not too much, right? Mecca comforted himself. He moved quickly and filled the empty bottles with dark red blood. For a moment, the three-headed dog in his sleep twitched. I don't know if it was cramped or the blood was drawn too quickly, and the body reacted. This scared Mecca, who was afraid that it would wake up suddenly. Fortunately, there was no danger. He moved faster to avoid accidents. Everything went on quietly, and no one knew. Just as Mecca was putting the cork into the bottle filled with blood, footsteps sounded again in the darkness. Oh no, Mecca was startled again. Someone came from the corridor and was coming here quickly. The footsteps were hurried and they soon arrived outside the door. Quick, faster, faster. Mecca Anders felt anxious, and he hurriedly put away the blood-filled potion bottle and put it in his pocket. The figure of the visitor was vague not far away, and the outline could be vaguely seen. It seemed that he had heard a strange noise and was coming quickly. And the syringe, Mecca felt as if her heart was beating out of her chest. He quickly withdrew the golden syringe from the three-headed dog and placed it snugly in the lining, and then a whisper sounded in the darkness. The figure suddenly froze, and after confirming that there was someone here, he strode forward. The outline in the darkness becomes clearer and clearer, and I have to break out of the darkness to meet him. Flap. Mecca's body shrank crazily, a flapping sound came from the darkness, and a shadow silently penetrated deeper into the darkness. Animagus. A figure came to where Mecca was just now. He raised his head and revealed a familiar face, which was Professor Snape. He looked at the direction in which the shadow left, thinking, who had broken into Hogwarts? Professor Snape turned his head and looked at the huge figure crawling in the darkness. The three-headed dog was sleeping, its sleek and oily hair rising and falling with the sound of snoring. The three-headed dog was hypnotized. His face darkened, and he quickly focused on the culprit, his eyes resting on the golden harp floating in the darkness, playing alone. Snape quickly understood. Someone had figured out the three-headed dog's dependence on music and used a harp to hypnotize it. He rushed into the darkness and found the heavy iron door that led to the secret passage. Quirinus Quirrell, is that you? Professor Snape glanced at the broken chains on the ground and rushed into the dark secret passage without thinking. On the top of the tower where the abandoned classroom was located, a shadow suddenly burst out of the skylight and hovered in the night sky. The black bat flapped its wings and glanced under the skylight with deep eyes. After finding that no one was chasing him, it retracted its wings and landed on the outer wall of the tower. The air outside is still clear. Mecca breathed a sigh of relief. He was not very tired at the moment, but his heartbeat was very fast, like beating a drum. No one wanted to do such an exciting chase and escape again. Huh, Mecca recalled the scene just now and was surprised. Something seemed wrong. Why was he so nervous? He realized at this moment that Quirrell had entered the secret passage, and the people coming from behind were more likely to be other professors from Hogwarts. He didn't do anything particularly bad. If he was caught, he would most likely be expelled from Hogwarts. Of course, this was an unacceptable punishment. After all, losing his status as a Hogwarts student would make his education path difficult. But it's not like facing life and death, where the heartbeat is ridiculously fast and breathing stops. Maybe it's because I'm a good student. Mecca sighed. This can only be attributed to the fact that he usually abides by the rules and rarely breaks them, and since he was drawing blood from Hagrid's pet and hurting his pet, he inevitably felt guilty. Mecca rested for a while, and felt a sharp pain in his head. He quickly flew down from the sky and landed in an open space on the ground. The remaining, magical will, is at work. He reacted quickly, took out the blood from his pocket in a deserted corner, and poured it onto the blood mark on the back of his hand. The absorption speed is much faster. Mecca saw that the dark red blood was just dripping and was absorbed instantly. But the headache hadn't gone away yet. He continued to pour blood. He felt a little heartbroken as he watched the blood in the bottle become empty little by little. This was just a waste of money. As the fourth bottle of blood was used up, the headache disappeared, and Mecca breathed a sigh of relief. It's finally over. He painfully put away the empty bottle and the last bottle of blood. It's time to go back. Mecca felt that the magical will in his body was being absorbed at an extremely fast speed, and inexplicable memories and fragments appeared in his mind. Correspondingly, the regression process of the magic level was terminated. Now he needs to find a place to digest it. Maybe after today, the magic will be completely converted into spell proficiency and no longer exist. Now all the spells related to transfiguration are at level 9. Will there be any changes at level 10? Mecca was looking forward to it. Level 10 was considered a threshold after all. There should be some changes. After taking a short rest, he glanced in the distance in the direction of Gryffindor's dormitory and saw lightning flashing across the clouds. It looks like it's going to rain. We have to go back quickly. Mecca whispered, and the shadows on the ground squirmed crazily. A pitch-black bat suddenly passed through the shade of the trees overhead, picked up a few leaves, and flew into the night sky. A bolt of lightning pierced the night sky. The wind blew loudly, and fallen leaves swept through the air. There is a washroom on the road leading to the Forbidden Book area. The sound of water is gurgling. The water overflows from the washroom. The sound of breaking rocks and tiles is heard frequently from inside. A thin figure hides in the washroom compartment. She covered her mouth and held her breath, her trembling hands showing her fear and helplessness. The troll outside blocked her way. She escaped here, but was still caught up. What should I do? Hermione was anxious. Now the troll was breaking apart the compartments, trying to catch her out. She grasped the wand tightly with her other hand, but the power gap was too great. The giant monster could resist due to its huge size. The spell she cast was like water entering the sea without making any waves. The roar in her ears was getting closer and closer, like a wild beast. She could imagine the giant monster looking fiercely for its hidden prey. Boom! There was a loud noise, and a wall collapsed outside. White gravel powder fell into the water, and followed the water into the crack of the door. The troll roared and struck everywhere. It was venting its anger, and a mouse was hiding from it. It's turning its head, and it's going to start checking the compartment over here. Hermione's heart felt like it was on fire. She saw the shadow on the ground turn around and come over here. Her mind was racing, trying to think of a way to escape, while she was praying, hoping that the troll would start looking for it from the far compartment. But she was disappointed. Bang! The compartment on the side was shattered, and Hermione saw flying tiles falling from above her head, hitting her feet and causing splashes. She seemed to be speechless. This power was so overwhelming, her body was shaking like a sieve, and she shrank into the corner of the compartment. Go that way, be sure to go that way, don't choose the cubicle in this corner. She prayed again, hoping for God's blessing, but her lucky heart was broken again and she froze. The giant's gray souls came to the door. It stopped and chose this as its second target. Its hard souls easily crushed the stones on the soles of its feet. Hermione felt a darkness hit her head. She looked up and saw a ferocious mace raised above her head and suddenly smashed down. Boom! A corner of the compartment that could block the giant monster's gaze was broken, and the huge and ferocious head looked down and looked at her. Hermione suddenly screamed. She raised her wand to make the final resistance, chanted the spell quickly, and a white light shot out. The giant monster tilted its head indifferently, and the light grazed its eyes, disappeared into its stone-gray face, and disappeared in a flash. Its body swayed slightly, barely detectable. Hermione was desperate, her eyes were gleaming with fear. But stubbornness arose in her heart, and she wanted to resist. She pushed the door of the cubicle hard, trying to find a chance to escape, and ran as hard as she could. But the door didn't move at all, being held up by the collapsed wall outside. She felt something strange moving above her head, so she raised her head and stared at the monster's ferocious head. The giant monster smiled indifferently, stretched out its huge palm, and came in from above its head. "Is this what you want?" Hermione's eyes widened, fear seizing her heart. The troll's hand reached for her hair, and an irresistible force surged up, and her whole body was about to be pulled into the air. "Hermione, Nikar, where are you?" A voice called from outside. It was Harry. The troll's hand paused. Hermione was so surprised that she didn't even care about the pain. Someone was coming to save her. "Troll, troll," Ron's voice trembled when he saw the giant monster. There were footsteps in twos and threes, and it seemed that there were only two people. Hermione could tell that they were walking alone, without the professor following them. The troll roared, turned its head, and cast an indifferent gaze. Hermione was shocked when she saw the troll's movements, and she yelled at the top of her lungs. "Run, run away." Chapter 51. Hermione. Harry was startled. He heard Hermione's voice coming from the corner. Was it blocked by the troll in the corner of the bathroom? "Hermione, are you okay?" he shouted, wanting to know about Hermione. Hermione was coughing, dust was flying in the bathroom, and her voice was hoarse. "I'm fine, let's go." There was a sound of something falling. The troll loosened its grip on Hermione and stared at Harry's face. It twitched its nose as if it was trying to identify the scent of its prey. It was actually more interested in Harry and the others. It turned around and headed towards Harry. Hermione groaned in pain, and her voice came from the closed compartment. "Let's go, Harry, take Ron with you, we can't deal with it." "Ron," Harry took a deep breath, "are you scared?" Ron swallowed. "Afraid, of course I am, such a big monster." "You go first, Ron." Harry did not blame him. He raised his wand and faced the giant monster and said, "I will contain it. You leave quickly. If you run late, we may all have to stay here." Ron's teeth were trembling. He suddenly gritted his teeth, grabbed the gravel on the ground, and threw it at the troll, "You Merlin pants." Harry was startled, wasn't he afraid? The stone hit the giant monster's body and shattered immediately. It was provoked, roared, and walked towards Ron and the others. The water on the ground surged under its feet, and its speed became faster and faster. "Harry, it's staring at me now, you take the opportunity to Hermione." The ferocious huge mace suddenly fell down, creating a hole in the ground. The gravel flew into the ground. The two of them were unable to avoid it and were thrown away by the aftermath. Fortunately, there were no sharp things around. The two of them grimaced in pain. The ground got up. Ron stared at the sweeping mace, his eyelids trembling. If this mace hits his head, will it explode like a watermelon? "I'll do it." Harry rested against the wall for a while, and then quickly ordered Ron to find an opportunity to move some large rocks outside the compartment to rescue Hermione. He stared intently, raised his wand, and faced the ferocious giant monster. He whispered. All petrified, a white light flashed away. Traces of petrification appeared on the monster's face. It stopped, tilted its head, and suddenly roared violently. The traces of petrification immediately shattered. As it shook its head, some stone skin fell to the ground. Turn into powder and dissipate. Harry was surprised. The spell didn't work at all. Hermione noticed the light of the spell. She anxiously told the reason why the troll was not afraid of the spell. This was probably because the troll was too big. She advised. We can't fight it. We need to find the professors. You should leave quickly. I'm fine now. Harry smiled. How could he not hear the tremor in Hermione's voice? She was obviously scared, but she was pretending to be okay. Ron, are you leaving? He asked. Why are you walking? Ron cursed. I've been beaten, so if I run away now, I'm really a weakling. George and the others can laugh at me forever. Harry heard sobs coming from the compartment, and Hermione heard their conversation. He didn't know whether he was scared or moved, but he had no intention of comforting him. He saw the troll looking suspiciously at him, but he was not smart enough, shallow. He was alerted. Was this giant monster more interested in his prey? The troll no longer twitched its ugly nose. It completely locked onto Harry, with excitement in its eyes, as if it was the best prey. The mace with sharp bone spurs dragged on the ground, and the troll rushed towards Harry, swung the club and smashed it into his face. Harry was so frightened that his hair stood on end, and the death threat made him unable to breathe smoothly. He avoided it in a panic, and the mace whizzed past his head, removing the wall covering and carving a hole in the top of the wall. Under the huge force of squeezing, some gravel scratched the side of Harry's face, causing blood. It almost passed through his eye and blinded him. This power, Harry quickly crawled away, taking advantage of the troll to pull out the mace from the wall, and he pulled some distance away. He was panting, and his face was bloodshot from the strenuous exercise. He quickly understood that there was a huge disparity in power, and if he wanted to escape, he had to outwit them. You can't aim at the giant monster's body. The magic spell is ineffective against it, but if you don't aim at it, how can you hurt it and force it back? Harry's heart was beating violently. He was scared and thinking of a way. He stared at the mace, and lightning seemed to flash through his heart. Ron's eyes were worried. After he glanced at Harry, he walked around to remove the stones blocking the compartment. He held his breath and did not dare to take a breath because he had to pass by the giant monster's thighs, side. Harry also saw Ron's movements. He prayed for Ron and stared closely at the troll's movements. Suddenly, the troll suddenly turned its head and stared at the mouse passing by its feet with indifferent eyes. Single quote. Ron lowered his head and did not dare to look. There was a huge shadow covering him. His legs began to shake, but he still moved forward little by little. Harry was so frightened that he wanted to raise his wand and use the magic spell to attract the troll again and rescue Ron, but he quickly breathed a sigh of relief. The troll turned its head and looked towards him, as if it was only interested in him. One person is interested. It seems that my flesh and blood may be more fragrant. Harry pretended to laugh at himself and relieved some of his nervousness. He took a deep breath, grabbed a stone on the ground and threw it at the troll's eyes. Come here, he challenged. The giant monster took one step forward, like a cheetah pouncing on its prey. The hard soles of its feet crushed an unknown amount of gravel, and dust rose up under its feet. It cracked the corners of its mouth, as if it was mocking the rat in front of it for not overestimating its own capabilities. It picked up the ferocious mace and put the bone spurs against its face, intending to smash Harry's head into pieces. Buzz! Harry's ears were ringing, and there was a roar that shook his eardrums. He blindly jumped backwards, avoided some distance, gritted his teeth and raised his wand to face the mace. Ron's attention was drawn. He was pushing away a stone slab, and the sight took his breath away for a moment. The mace hit Harry's head with overwhelming force. Harry used his tiny wand to resist, almost like a mantis trying to block the car. Ron's eyes were horrified, as if he had seen Harry's head bleeding. The dazzling white light suddenly exploded. Wingardium Leviosa. Floating spell. The huge mace suddenly stopped in midair, and the huge inertia brought up strong winds, blowing off Harry's glasses. The giant monster's eyes showed surprise. It was surprised that it couldn't control the mace in its hand. The veins in the hand it was holding suddenly popped out. Before Harry could breathe a sigh of relief, the mace moved, and the huge force came back. The wand in Harry's hand flew away. He looked surprised and reached out to grab the wand. There was a shadow falling on his head. He raised his head suddenly, his heartbeat was about to jump out of his chest. The giant monster was grinning ferociously. It picked up the mace and faced him again. This time it was probably going to smash his face completely into his skull. Harry, Ron roared, grabbing the stone at hand and smashing it as hard as he could. Asshole, look at me. Hermione heard the movement outside and her voice trembled. Harry, leave me alone and run. Harry's heart was beating extremely fast. He was defenseless and couldn't hide. He gritted his teeth and stared at the giant monster that wanted to kill him, trying to remember its face. Boom! The air screamed, then suddenly became silent. Harry watched the huge mace stop on his face, already touching his hair, making him break into a cold sweat. He was surprised and delighted. What was going on? The next moment, he saw the troll roaring unwillingly. He put away his mace and ran wildly into the distance on all fours. The speed was frightening, and he disappeared into the night after a while. Soon, footsteps sounded at the end of the corridor, and a short figure walked towards him with disheveled hair. He has messy silver hair on his head, an old face, and limbs like a child. He is coming at a very fast pace. This is the Professor of Charms, Phileas Flyvee. Are the children okay? Professor Flitwick arrived. Harry breathed a sigh of relief and slumped to the ground. He lay on his back and gasped for air. Ron breathed a sigh of relief, and his face was no longer ferocious, but the voice in the cubicle began to cry. Professor Flitwick used his wand to move a large piece of huge stone and rescued Hermione from the compartment. With a serious look on his face, he criticized several people for not listening to the professor's words, not following the rules, and actually running out privately. Finally, he explained why came suddenly. Professor Snape was worried about your safety and asked me to come to you. Harry and others were surprised. How could it be Snape? He didn't have the slightest fondness for Harry and repeatedly targeted him in class. But Professor Flitwick was very sure that it was Professor Snape who was worried about them and asked him to take care of them many times. He also asked several people what kind of punishment they would receive. You almost lost your lives. This lesson must be deeply remembered by you. You can tell yourself how to punish you. Ron stammered. How about deducting some Gryffindor credits? Professor Flitwick shook his head. This was impossible. Professor Flitwick, Hermione begged while wiping her tears, finally hitting Professor Flitwick, and he relented. Forget it, I'll let you go this time. If there is a next time, I will inform Professor McGonagall about this and she will punish you twice. I hope you will remember it. Then Mecca, Harry thought twice, but still told Mecca's whereabouts, saying that he had not found Mecca yet and was afraid that Mecca would be in danger. Professor Flitwick looked serious. This is not something you should consider. I will find the whereabouts of Mecca Anders. You should go back to your dormitory as soon as possible and don't come out again. Under his arrangement, Harry and the others left in the opposite direction of the troll, heading back to Gryffindor's dormitory. Professor Flitwick stared at the direction in which the giant monster disappeared. He was puzzled. How could this giant monster know how to listen to footsteps? It seemed to have intelligence that was different from other giant monsters. He put aside his thoughts and moved quickly to chase the fleeing giant monster to prevent anyone from being injured or even killed by it. Soon, Professor Flitwick's short figure quickly disappeared into the night. The black bat soars in the night sky. Its wings are much more majestic than those of ordinary bats. It can fly a long distance with a single flapping in the night sky. It was looking at the situation on the ground with bright eyes, alerting people who arrived suddenly, and preventing its whereabouts from being noticed and its identity being revealed. Suddenly, several figures came into view. Harry's face was actually hurt. Mecca Anders was a little surprised, because in his opinion, the trolls were not smart enough and could easily be tricked by others. With Hermione and Harry's wit and magical talents, they should be safe and sound just like the memories of their previous lives. That's right. Could it be that my butterfly caused the change? He flapped his wings, flew down from the air, turned into a human form in the corner, and met several people walking in the corridor at the corner. Mecca, Harry said in surprise. He was worried when he unexpectedly met Mecca around the corner. Ron and Hermione were also very happy. They were all safe and sound, with only some superficial injuries. They hurriedly asked where Mecca had gone. Mecca looked at the tears on Hermione's face, and it seemed that something unexpected had happened, but luckily she was not in danger. He responded with a smile. I also rushed to the forbidden book area, but I encountered a troll running rampant on the way, so I chose to take a detour. I didn't expect to miss you all the way. Ron covered his heart. You don't know how powerful that giant monster is. As they talked, they walked faster, trying to get back to the Gryffindor dormitory before others noticed. In the secret passage under the abandoned classroom, there were net-like vines that blocked the entire dark space. The walls and floor were covered with them. An invisible figure was exploring it and walking through every corner. This place is actually full of dead ends. Professor Quirrell looked ugly. He had spent so much effort and finally entered the secret passage, but it turned out that this was a confined space. There was no trace of ordinary stones, let alone the thing he was eager to get. Is Hogwarts playing tricks on me? He tore off a piece of the vines on the wall in a rage. If that was the case, he might still have to return empty-handed. As this, Quirrell was suddenly startled and hurriedly left the place to stay away from the wall. He felt the ground moving and black shadows flashed past. He looked down and saw that they were actually those dark green vines. It's actually moving. Is this a magical plant? Professor Quirrell understood immediately that this seemingly ordinary vine was actually not a natural vegetation, but a magical plant that someone had raised here, and it had strange abilities. He was not angry but happy. This magical plant was probably protecting something when it stayed here. This meant that he was on the right track, but what kind of magical plant was it? Quirrell left the place again, and the vines were climbing up his body, seeming to trap him in the huge vines. His steps were fast, but his face became solemn. If he was surrounded, he would probably die here. He felt that these vines were extremely tough and powerful and could strangle people alive. Quirinas. A hoarse voice sounded at the right time, "This is a devil's net. Use light and heat to disperse them." It turns out to be a devil's net. Professor Quirrell suddenly realized. He stretched out his wand and whispered. The wand lit up with bright white light, dispelling the darkness. Under the illumination of the light, the vines around the feet faded quickly. They moved very quickly, as if they were afraid of the light, and were gathering towards the depths of darkness. The hoarse voice seemed to have noticed something strange and said, "Go to the right. There is a road behind the devil's net." Road. Quirrell turned around quickly, and sure enough he saw the vines crawling quickly, and accidentally leaked a small gap. What was behind them was not a wall, but darkness. This was indeed a road. Quirrell was pleasantly surprised. He headed there and used light to disperse the remaining vines blocking the road. Soon, a passage gradually opened up behind the vines, almost large enough to accommodate him. But he immediately put away the wand, the light on the wand dissipated, and the surroundings returned to darkness. He hid in the corner vigilantly, without making any noise, when someone came from behind. "Quirinus Quirrell." A cold voice came from the darkness, and a tall figure stepped out of the shadows. He stared at the place where Quirrell was hiding with cold eyes. "Come out, thief who came to Hogwarts." Professor Snape took out his wand. "Snape." Quirrell knew he couldn't hide, so he walked out with a solemn expression on his face, because the man in front of him was talented and powerful in magic. "Oh," Professor Snape's indifferent expression flashed with surprise, "you actually changed your face specially, Professor Quirrell." Quirrell didn't answer at all. He just thought that he was an outsider, not a professor at Hogwarts. He suddenly asked, "How did you get here?" "Of course we are here to catch the thief." Professor Snape looked at him coldly. He raised his wand, and a sharp invisible blade pierced the air, making a horrifying sound like a swarm of bees tearing apart. Professor Quirrell dodged in horror, and the sharp edge passed by him, tearing countless devil's net vines behind him into pieces, and large pieces fell down, even the wall was pierced, leaving horrific knife marks. He knew that he was invincible. If he was touched by such a sharp edge, his body would probably break into several pieces. He fled in a hurry, and his body disappeared from the place. He had already used the illusion body spell to become invisible. Professor Snape chased after him, the light piercing the darkness like lightning. The invisible edge was venting, and the horrifying sounds came one after another, chasing after him like gangrene in the bones. The two rushed out of the secret passage one after another and came to the abandoned classroom outside. There was a soft harp solo, accompanied by the snoring of a three-headed dog. Etc. Quirrell's face was ugly, and there were several deep blood marks on his body, which were as deep as the bones. They were just scratched by invisible sharp edges in the dark. He saw Professor Snape making another move and hurriedly said, "Aren't you afraid something will happen to Harry Potter and Meka-Anders?" "What do you mean?" Professor Snape narrowed his eyes. Seeing him stop his movements, Professor Quirrell breathed a sigh of relief. He was right. Snape really valued the two of them. He smiled and asked, "Have you seen that giant monster?" Professor Snape didn't respond, staring at him coldly. Professor Quirrell said to himself, "When I was taming this giant monster, I sent it to hunt for food. I was surprised to find that it had intelligence that was different from ordinary giant monsters. It knew how to hunt and would quietly hunt. Hide yourself and wait for prey. Then when the prey is defenseless, use the mace you carry to smash the prey's head into pieces, like this." He imitated the movements of the troll and made a bang sound from his mouth. Professor Snape looked at his actions and said coldly, "What do you want to say?" Professor Quirrell smiled and continued, "It seems to be the leader of the giant monsters, so it has such amazing hunting skills, but what I'm more surprised about is that it holds a grudge. It will run away when it is outmatched. Remember the breath of the creature you fought with, and you will kill that creature when it is alone and is off guard. Professor Snape's face darkened. He knew what Quirrell wanted to express. Sure enough, Quirrell took out two hairs from his pocket and added with a smile. This is the hair of Harry Potter and Mecca Anders. With their scent, I gave it to the giant monster to smell. Professor Snape's face turned gloomy. Professor Quirrell suddenly stopped smiling, pointed his wand, the sound of the piano ended, and the snoring stopped. In the darkness, the huge lantern suddenly opened, roared, and a bloody mouth suddenly bit down on the unsuspecting Snape. At the same time, Mecca and Harry were walking in a hurry, and finally saw the Gryffindor Tower in front of them. Ron was beaming with joy, and they chatted quietly. No one saw them along the way, and they avoided being punished by the school. This was undoubtedly a great thing. The late night is as silent as water. Mecca Anders' expression suddenly changed. He pushed Harry away, and a huge figure rushed out from the corner. The mace fell on his head, trying to kill both of them. Boom! The moment Mecca Anders pounced on Harry, the huge mace fell down and smashed the wall behind him. The rubble and tiles fell on the two people. Mecca didn't have time to think. He got up from the ground immediately. He grabbed Harry's arm and dragged him back. The second stick almost didn't stop. The wind was howling in the face. An anxious voice sounded behind him. Wingardium Leviosa. The white light flashed. Hermione pointed her wand at the mace, and the floating spell was exerted. The mace paused for a moment. Mecca avoided it, and Harry rolled away. The troll was furious. The hunt failed. It roared angrily, and the muscles in its thick arms burst out. The huge force was applied to the mace in its hand. It clenched it and lifted it, and the mace fell again. Hermione screamed, and the wand in her hand had already flown out. This was the backlash of power. She couldn't hold it at all. She staggered and fell to the ground. Run, Ron yelled. Harry, Micah, run. He knew that no one could stop this giant monster, and only by running away could he save his life. He rushed forward regardless of the danger, trying to break into the falling rocks and flying ash to pull the two away from where they were. The giant's roar was deafening, and the mace was about to fall with an unstoppable force. The violent wind was whistling, and the force was too great to penetrate the air. Hermione almost dared not breathe. She was afraid to see Micah's head standing in front of her explode immediately under this blow. Combizer Rocketum, a whisper sounded in the white ash. The mace swung by the giant monster trembled violently in the air, and there was a flash of surprise in its eyes. The whistling wind stopped abruptly, and the mace in its hand turned into gravel. It had no place to vent its huge power, and the gravel was immediately crushed and turned into powder. Its body rushed forward due to inertia. Micah ducked down, and the troll hit the heavy stone pillar. With a loud bang, the stone pillar was covered with cracks and was almost smashed to pieces. Transformation spell. Hermione was surprised. This was a spell related to transfiguration, which could change the position and properties of objects, but it was not something that first-year students should learn. Harry was pulled away by Ron, and the two hid in the distance. Seeing that Micah was safe, they both breathed a sigh of relief. What a powerful force. Micah got up from the ground in shock and threw away the mace in his hand. This was a successful animal position exchange between the gravel in his hand and the troll's mace, but he felt particularly strenuous. The troll's power was too great, and the mace was unbelievably heavy. He was panting because of a series of violent movements in a short period of time. At this moment, his heartbeat was as fast as a drum, but he stared at the eyes of the troll in front of him. He saw that the troll's eyes actually had human emotions. How can a troll be intelligent? Micah was puzzled, but no one could answer him. The giant got up from the ground, and its iron gray fist had sunk into the ground. It pulled it out suddenly, and water gushed out from the ground, revealing a broken water pipe. The corridor began to accumulate water, and the sound of water was so clear in the silent night. The giant turned around, shook its hideous head, and relieved the dizziness caused by the collision. It locked its eyes on Mecca, raised its head and roared, and pounced on all fours like a beast. Its speed was too fast, and its movements were too swift. The ground rumbled and actually vibrated. The water exploded under his feet, splashing everywhere, and its body rushed forward. Mecca was startled, and this smashed him to pieces. He grabbed a handful of gravel from the ground and threw it towards him, chanting a spell quickly. He pointed his wand, and a bright light flew into the gravel in the air. Buzz, buzz, buzz. A flock of birds were chirping. The sound was so sharp and piercing that it seemed to pierce the eardrums of people. In the flying ashes, the gravel struggled to become white birds, flying very fast and straight like arrows, flying towards the troll's eyeballs. This is the bird summoning spell. Harry was about to go forward to help, but he was shocked to see this scene and froze in his place. He had never seen Micah cast this spell before. The troll was rushing, and it stretched out its hand to slap the flying bird in front of it in annoyance. It lost its balance without paying attention, and its body rolled on the ground, like an iron ball rolling, with a huge sound. It roared to the sky and finally stopped before hitting the wall again. The floor of the corridor, which had been old, had already rolled out cracks. Roar! The troll roared, staring at Micah with a fierce and angry look, wishing to tear him to pieces. Micah tentatively cast a spell, which fell into the body of the troll, which further aroused its ferocity. How is it possible? Micah couldn't believe it. He found that his spell had no effect on the troll at all, it just made it stiff for a moment. You know, he was full of confidence, and now he released a 9th-level spell. Hermione spoke in time, and she quickly explained why the troll was not affected by the spell, or because of the disparity in strength. She asked Micah to withdraw and run together. The huge noise might have attracted the attention of the professors and they could be rescued halfway. Micah did not respond, and his heart tightened. The troll in front of him was brewing the next attack. It stared at him with hatred, and its granite-like feet had sunk into the ground. It was exerting force. There was a loud bang. The ground shook, and the troll's eyes flashed cunningly. Not good. Micah's wand emitted a bright light, his expression tightened, and he spoke quickly, asking Harry and Ron to dodge. This troll was playing a feint to the east and attacking in the west. But it seemed too late. The giant turned around suddenly, the stone slabs under its feet exploded, and its body burst out at a terrifying speed, and pounced in front of Harry. Harry was startled and dodged, and it grabbed Ron's body like a doll. Ron screamed, he was terrified, his body was grabbed by an irresistible force, and struggling was useless. Abandoned classroom. A roar exploded behind his ears, and Professor Snape, who was talking to Quirrell, was startled. He turned around suddenly and saw a huge head flashing with green eyes. The sleeping three-headed dog suddenly woke up. It vented its anger for being woken up and bit down angrily. This time it might bite off its upper body. Quirrell's laughter rang in the darkness, and he was proud of his sneak attack. Professor Snape saw the huge mouth biting down, but he calmly closed his eyes instead. The three-headed dog's bloody mouth fell, and the white giant teeth bit down, and a handful of blood splashed into the darkness. Everything seemed to be a foregone conclusion. Quirrell was about to laugh and celebrate the removal of the obstacle in front of him, but he was suddenly stunned. A dazzling light burst out from the huge teeth that were biting together, as bright as day. There was a huge sound of broken glass, and a barrier that began to shatter supported the safe space, opening the bloody mouth and revealing the figure of Professor Snape. Professor Snape, who was in the bloody mouth, stared at Quirrell coldly. He walked out of the broken barrier and fell to the ground. His right foot was bloody and bleeding. The huge three-headed dog roared and spit out pieces of broken light. This was the remnant of the armor spell. Its huge mouth bit down again, wanting to swallow the escaped prey completely into its stomach and digest it completely. Fall to the ground. With a whisper, Professor Snape pointed his wand, and the three-headed dog's angry eyes froze, as if it was about to faint, and then stared fiercely. It was resisting the power of the coma spell. Professor Snape didn't care. He just whispered it again and fainted. The radiant light penetrated into the huge head. The huge body of the three-headed dog fell down with a bang. The three pairs of eyes were still wide open, but it had already fallen into a coma. Professor Quirrell, who had reacted, had already fled far away. Professor Snape released the flashing charm, which illuminated the dark space as if it were daytime. In the fleeting light, he saw Quirrell's figure and chased after him. The corridor in front of Gryffindor Tower. Ron, Harry saw Ron being pinched in the palm of the troll's hand, and he was angry and wanted to rush up to save Ron. A group of white birds flew towards the troll's eyeballs, close at hand. This was the bird summoning spell cast by Macaw. The troll could still react. It roared and slapped it away in an instant. The birds were blown into ashes in the huge force. Faint, Hermione's spell turned into a beam of white light and shot into the troll's head. It didn't react, but just shook its body. It stretched out its other hand and pinched Ron's head. Ron screamed, and his face was trembling with fear. No, Hermione's eyes widened and her face turned pale. Mecca, who had just cast the bird summoning spell, was shocked. Was he going to crush Ron's head to vent his anger? He was about to cast the spell again, but suddenly he felt a headache and his body was actually heating up. Is this the magic will that has taken effect again? This thought flashed through Mecca's mind, and he quickly discarded it. He was in a hurry and didn't have time to think about it. He had to save Ron from the troll's hands. In this moment, there was a change like a spring, flowing through Mecca's body in an instant. Before he noticed it, the remaining magic will in his body was completely consumed, and all the 9-level spells were instantly advanced. A brilliant light lit up in his body, transforming his body. The troll held Ron's head with his hand and glanced at the panicked people, with provocation in his eyes. It was taking this opportunity to vent its anger, and the weak mouse actually dared to resist and frequently teased it with magic spells. Collapse. Hermione made an anxious voice. She wanted to take this opportunity to save Ron. The troll saw the light coming towards its eyes. It closed its eyes and resisted the coma spell with its eyelids. It shook its body and roared. Ron's hair was pulled, and some hair was torn off and fell on the ground. On the ground. Ron screamed in pain. His scalp was about to be pulled out by the roots. Harry's wand had already been dropped while he was dodging. He was unarmed, so he grabbed the sharp gravel and rushed over, stabbing it at the troll's feet, but it had no effect. Instead, the gravel pierced his hand, bleeding. Come on, the giant monster's skin is as hard as a rock, motionless. Get away. Mecca Anders was anxious. Harry's behavior was too risky. He sent out a magic spell, and the intense light flashed, trying to replace the stone on the ground and Ron's position with a conversion spell, but it failed. The level of the magic spell was far different. This was just trying. Blood soon started to bleed from the corner of his mouth, and he was attacked. Backlash. But there is warmth flowing in the body, soothing the damage caused by the backlash. Mecca was stunned. At this moment, he felt the changes in his body. His body was warm, and an inexplicable heat flowed through his body, transforming his body, and there was still heat gushing out from nowhere. Feeling the movement at his feet, the troll kicked irritably, as if to drive away a fly. Harry was directly knocked away by the huge force, hit the wall and fell down. His face was ferocious, it was extremely painful. The troll's hand continued to exert force, and Harry, who fell to the ground, saw Ron's head being grabbed, and his body hanging and shaking in the air like a rag. He was struggling desperately, but the disparity in strength was terrifying. Harry gritted his teeth, endured the severe pain in his abdomen and climbed up, staggering over to stop him. The troll let out a ferocious smile. It grabbed Ron's body and head, and used both hands to separate him head and tail. Feeling the huge force acting on his body, Ron screamed heartbreakingly. Harry staggered halfway and tripped over the gravel on the ground. He struggled for a while and couldn't get up for a short time. His teeth were almost broken and he tried desperately to get up. Hermione was harassing the troll with spell after spell. Her face was pale. She had used spells too frequently, and her body was exhausted. Even her eyes were bloodshot and red. This was due to excessive mental exertion. The giant grinned and roared, listening to the screams in its ears. There was joy and pride in its roar. Its hands began to separate, and it wanted to completely tear the person in its hands into two halves. The robe on Ron's body was already making the sound of shredded cloth. The sound started to tear first, and then it violently exerted force. Ron, Harry and Hermione shouted in horror. A bright light flashed like snow-white lightning. A sharp roar suddenly sounded, and the giant monster was stunned. Its arms were pierced, and blood spurted out like a waterfall of blood. Its muscles and bones were injured. It grinned in pain and jumped on the spot, not caring about the prey on its palms, and threw it out casually. Harry and Hermione witnessed this scene, and they were stunned. What was that? Why were the troll's arms suddenly pierced? Mecca caught Ron and put the shocked Ron on the ground. He breathed a sigh of relief, stood up, and pointed his wand at the troll who was roaring in pain again. The troll felt threatened, it roared angrily, and blood was still pouring out of its arms. It ignored it and charged towards Mecca. "What a beast Turfshin is," Nikar whispered. "This is the transfiguration spell." The stone on the ground glowed white, and a sharp silver arrow shot out of the light, piercing the air at a speed too fast to react. With a shrill roar, it pierced the monster's knee, and there was another waterfall of blood. Transfiguration curse. Hermione was lost in thought. She had never thought that the transformation curse could have such power. She reacted quickly and rushed over with Harry, placing Ron farther away to avoid causing trouble to Mecca. The monster's knees were pierced, and its charging body instantly lost its balance and fell to its knees. It panicked in its eyes and turned around to run away with a roar. Tevishman is so deep. Mecca did not chase, he looked at its figure calmly. A dazzling beam of light fell into the water at the feet of the giant monster. The water seemed to be boiling, bubbles emerged, and then the light faded away, and the water surface turned golden and oily. This turned the water into a pool of oil. The giant monster stepped on the oily water, and his body suddenly became unstable and turned over. The huge inertia caused him to hit the wall nearby. The wall collapsed and cracks spread out. It panicked and rolled in the oil pool. It was unable to escape for a short time. It looked back at Mecca, who was pointing the wand at his head. There was fear in his eyes. It roared, begging for mercy this time. Mecca didn't respond. He recited a spell in a low voice, and a light lit up on the wand. Suddenly, his expression moved, and when he looked back, he saw many footsteps approaching, and the light on the wand suddenly dimmed. The troll took the opportunity to roll out of the accumulated oil under his feet, stumbled all the way, and fled into the night in embarrassment. Mecca ignored it. Its fate was determined next. The professors would deal with it. He quickly processed the scene and turned the oil back into water. The accumulated water washed it away, and the blood stains on the ground were much reduced. Mecca quietly put away her wand again, followed Harry and the others, and quickly gave instructions, guiding them to attribute their safety to the unity of everyone, and instructing them not to reveal that they had fought against the troll head-on. Harry and Hermione looked at each other and agreed, and Ron, who was resting on the ground, nodded weakly. He was greatly frightened and had not yet fully recovered. Soon, several professors came from the corridor. "Who can tell me what is going on?" Professor McGonagall was frightened. She saw the water and residual blood stains on the ground in front of her, and quickly stepped forward to check the physical condition of several people. Harry hesitated, not daring to tell the truth, and Ron became even more silent, not even making a sound. After an examination by Professor McGonagall, she learned that all three of Harry's were injured. Harry's ribs were broken, Hermione was so weak that she almost fainted, and Ron's feet on the ground also had broken bones and were crushed by the troll. Fortunately, his head was fine and he only lost some hair and scalp. Among these people, only Mecca was unharmed. This was the result of the heat flow in his body. Professor McGonagall quickly asked Madame Pomfrey from the school hospital to come over and send the three people for treatment. After doing this, her face darkened. "Who asked you to take risks here?" It's me." Harry shrank, frightened by Professor McGonagall's stern gaze, but he still raised his hand, claiming that he had brought everyone out. Hermione wanted to retort, but she hesitated. She was worried that if she admitted that it was her going to the restricted area that caused all this to happen, would she be expelled from Hogwarts and never have anything to do with the wizarding world again? "Actually," Hermione finally said, "this has nothing to do with her, it's my problem." Harry said hastily, seeing Hermione's face. He knew that if she wanted to take over all the mistakes, this would be a big deal and she might really be expelled. Silence. Professor McGonagall glared at him, and she asked Hermione to continue. Hermione said matter-of-factly, "They are here to find me." She slowly said that they found that they were missing, so they searched all the way, but they were in danger. They encountered a vicious troll. After a few people cooperated, they managed to wait until the professors arrived. Professor McGonagall listened and nodded. When several children were in such danger, they could still help each other regardless of danger. It was a rare friendship. Hermione bit her lip and finally told the original reason, "The reason why I came out alone is because." It's because she left the book in the library. Mecca, who had always had no sense of presence, suddenly said. He saw that Professor McGonagall's expression had eased, indicating that he was gradually relieved of the mistakes of several people. He realized that this was a good breakthrough, but it was still not enough, so he took the initiative to speak out. Hermione was startled when she heard this. Professor McGonagall glared at him, telling him to shut up and stop interfering. Mecca seemed not to notice, and he explained, "This is actually my fault and has nothing to do with them." Hermione was stunned. This matter really had the least to do with Mecca, because he was safe and sound, but he was stopped by the troll just after he was about to join them in Gryffindor Tower. She was a little suspicious that the intelligent giant monster was eyeing her, so it came after her. Mecca's tone was sincere. "You also know that Hermione's performance in class is not due to simple talent. The bigger reason is that she loves books like her life and often spends time in the library. But she forgot her book in the library that day, and said at the Halloween party that she would get it after the party, and that's what happened." Quote. Professor McGonagall nodded involuntarily after hearing this. She agreed. This little girl really liked reading. She could often see her carrying several books with her. Mecca continued. "After the troll attack, you arranged for us to go back to the dormitory, but on the way back, I discovered that Hermione was missing. I remembered that she had said at the banquet that she was going to get the library. I was so panicked that I didn't tell the professor, but instead called Harry and Ron." Mecca hesitated, seeming to be thinking about something important. "Then what?" Professor McGonagall said. She asked Mecca not to hide the facts and to tell the whole story. Mecca gritted her teeth, remained silent for a long time, and finally said, "I am actually still looking for excitement, thinking that on the way to find Hermione, I can witness the appearance of a giant monster that I have never seen before." Professor McGonagall looked at his face and nodded slowly. She was a little convinced. This was a common mentality among the young wizards at Hogwarts. In the past, students who violated school rules were mostly because of their strong curiosity and liked to seek excitement. That led to punishment and expulsion. Mecca took the initiative to expose the shortcomings, and explained that Harry and others took over the responsibility because he requested it in advance. This was because he was afraid of being punished. He finally apologized sincerely. "This is my problem. I'm sorry for them. I hope you won't blame them for lying for me. If you want to punish them, just punish me." Harry was stunned. How could he explain it this way? He quickly received Mecca's wink and hurriedly put away his surprised expression, lowered his head and closed his mouth. Hermione's performance was also very good. She saw the change in Professor McGonagall's expression. This was a sign that she was gradually recognizing their actions and tending to forgive their mistakes. McGonagall took a look at the injuries of several people and hesitated. Professor Flitwick behind him suddenly said, "This is my fault too, Professor McGonagall." He explained that if he had not been anxious to chase the troll, he would have noticed the abnormality outside Gryffindor Tower and would not have allowed several people to be almost killed at the door of the dormitory. "In fact, they also have merit." Professor Flitwick said, "If they were not here to fight against the troll would probably break into the Gryffindor dormitory." Mecca was also surprised. How could Professor Flitwick speak for them? Professor Flitwick felt his gaze and smiled at him, as if he appreciated it. Professor McGonagall was shocked after hearing Professor Flitwick's words. It was hard for her to imagine how much casualties such a huge monster would cause if it broke into the student dormitory. She finally relented. "For this reason, I will not expel any of you from Hogwarts." Hermione's face relaxed, finally overcoming the difficulty. "But," Professor McGonagall's face became solemn. "Since you have made a mistake, you must bear the corresponding responsibility. Gryffindor will deduct 50 points, and each of you will deduct 50 points. In addition, you must reflect on yourselves in confinement. Error." Professor McGonagall said that several people will be locked up for a period of time in the future. The specific location and time of confinement will be informed by her afterwards. Several people became worried again, not knowing what kind of confinement they would face. At this time, there were hurried footsteps again, and a figure arrived belatedly. "Professor Snape," Professor Flitwick said. Professor Snape glanced at the people present. He glanced at the faces of Harry and Mecca, his cold expression softened slightly, and turned back to briefly greet Professor Flitwick. Mecca's expression condensed, and she immediately noticed Professor Snape's right foot, which was bleeding heavily. "There's blood on his feet." Harry also noticed it and whispered, "And there's green slime." Hermione's face was startled, and she quickly looked towards Professor Snape. Sure enough, She saw blood oozing from under the robe, and there was unknown mucus sticking to the robe. She recognized the origin of the green mucus. Professor Snape glanced at her and she quickly lowered her head. When the matter came to an end, Mecca finally returned to the Gryffindor dormitory. Harry and Ron were receiving treatment in the school hospital, so he was the only one in the dormitory. After Mecca took a bath, she sat on the edge of the bed to check her changes. What happened to the body when it was confronting the troll? He suspected that this might be related to the fact that the magic level exceeded level 10. Mecca relaxed his mind and felt the changes in his body. At this moment, he still felt the heat flowing through his body. Soon, he understood something. Is this actually the awakening of magic power? Mecca was surprised in his heart. He had only heard that children with magical talents would experience a magical awakening. It might come quietly without any awareness, or it might be very noisy and cause some damage, but he had never heard of someone having a second magical awakening. Am I a strange flower? Mecca's face looked strange. He discovered that the magic awakening was still going on. This time the magic awakening was not very intense, but it still accelerated Mecca's path as a wizard and allowed him to quietly cross the threshold of a wizard. What is the reason for this second magic awakening? Mecca was puzzled. He thought about this problem while exploring the changes in his body. He felt the heat in his body moving toward his brain. He gradually felt the heat soothing his spirit, as if he was soaking in a hot bath. During this process, his eyes emitted a faint purple light in the dark night. This was the magic power appearing through the pupils, and it was also a symptom of the gradual filling of magic power in the body. This may have something to do with the deep wizarding roots. Mecca was thinking about the reason for the second awakening of magic power, and quickly thought of which book he had seen it in before, and someone came up with a guess. In the early stages of getting started as a wizard, if you can have a solid foundation and specialize in a certain field, learn all the basic spells at the same time, make the progress the same, and let the spells reach a certain height together, you will have the opportunity to develop a more powerful body. Multipotential. At that time, this conjecture was regarded as a joke. It was simply nonsense, because in the history of the wizarding world, no one had ever heard of anyone doing it. This requirement was extremely stringent. Some people affirmed that no one had ever heard of anyone doing this before, too, and I'm afraid there won't be any in the future. But whether the changes in the magic power of the body are related to this conjecture is difficult for Mecca to judge. There is really no precedent. This feeling is very comfortable. Mecca could feel that this heat flow was quietly converging on his head, and the heat in the rest of his body was gradually fading away, while most of the heat flow converging on his head was further massaging his spirit. This made him energetic at night, without any hint of the thrilling night. But this feeling of not being able to sleep makes Mecca feel helpless. Judging from the changes in her body, it is estimated that it will be completely stopped until tomorrow, and tonight will probably be a sleepless night. I have no choice but to wait until tomorrow when the magic awakening is completely over, and then I can dream about that duelist again. Mecca put away the duel medal in her hand, found a book about potions, leaned against the bed, and read the book in the light outside the window, waiting for the changes in her body to end. That night, Professor McGonagall expressed her opinion. Originally, if the giant monster had not caused any casualties, the school would have released it into the Forbidden Forest as a supplement to biological resources, but now she suggested that the giant monster should be killed as soon as possible. Because judging from the expressions of Mecca and others, this giant monster is not only cruel and will kill people when it gets angry, but it is also as cunning as a fox. It knows how to avoid the strong and even holds a grudge, waiting for its prey to take off its guard before launching a sudden surprise attack. If it is left alive, it may cause more casualties, which is unacceptable. Professor Snape, who was always taciturn, nodded in agreement with her point of view and took over the responsibility. "Leave it to me. Is it enough for you alone?" Professor McGonagall wanted to ask several professors to make a trip to complete this matter as quickly as possible to avoid further accidents. But Professor Snape refused. He said that one person would be enough and would solve the problem quickly, and then turned and left. In less than half an hour, Professor Snape came back from outside. Except for the blood stains on his right foot, his clothes were as clean as before. He dropped a huge bloody head on the ground for Professor McGonagall to inspect. Professor McGonagall immediately destroyed it, letting the ferocious head turn to ashes in the firelight, and the ashes returned to dust. The professors dispersed in the middle of the night. The next day, Mecca, who was still in high spirits after not sleeping all night, had eaten and drank in the auditorium and was about to leave. Harry and the other three, who had been discharged from the hospital successfully, suddenly called him aside. The three of them were sitting on the table, chatting about yesterday's events. Harry talked about the bite marks and green mucus on Professor Snape's right foot last night, and expressed his concern for the safety of Hogwarts. Mecca, there is green mucus and blood on Professor Snape's feet. If it is as we suspected, he may not be a good person. He may have taken the opportunity to do something he shouldn't have done last night. Mecca smiled. You want to say that Professor Snape broke into the abandoned classroom where the three-headed dog was last night? Not only that, Hermione added. The troll will appear in Hogwarts. Unless someone deliberately lets it in, its huge size will not be able to hide it from Professor Dumbledore. So who exactly put it in, and for what purpose? Quote. Mecca touched his chin, nodded and said. Your reasoning is very reasonable. I am afraid that the appearance of the troll was not an accident, but someone did it deliberately. It attracted the attention of almost all the professors last night, and it indeed made it more convenient for those who wanted to enter the abandoned classroom. The injury on Professor Snape's foot proves that he entered the abandoned classroom, so Professor Snape is indeed suspected of smuggling trolls. Quote. Harry answered. If Professor Snape has indeed done the above things, then the most dangerous person is probably you who often meets him. Mecca smiled and explained that he had spent some time with Professor Snape and had some understanding of Snape. The truth might not necessarily be what he had guessed. Harry gave further evidence. I heard that in the wizarding world, there are dark wizards who are crazy. They lack the kindness that normal people should have, so their actions cannot be judged by common sense. You see, Professor Snape and I have nothing to do with each other and have never met each other, but the way he looked at me and the way he targeted me in class seemed to be out of some malice. I think this is part of his morbid psychology. Quote. Ron was in a good mood and had actually recovered from the terrible experience last night. He patted Mecca on the shoulder and said in a mature manner. I think Harry is right. You'd better stay away from him. He suddenly shrank his neck and put his hand down. A familiar figure was approaching. He seemed to have been standing there for a while. Harry and Hermione also saw it and were silent for a while. They actually said bad things about the person in front of the person involved without realizing it. Anders, Professor Snape waved and asked Macaw to come over, then he walked out of the hall. Ron gave Macaw a look, meaning that he could only wish for the best. Macaw smiled, he stood up and walked to the door of the hall, and found that Professor Snape was followed by two strangers, one with golden hair and a calm gaze, and the other with long black hair and a cold look. He quietly looked at the faces of the two people and talked to Professor Snape, "Why did you ask me to come over?" Professor Snape introduced the two people beside him. The young man with golden hair was the chief examiner in charge of the potion rating assessment this time, and the middle-aged man with long black hair was the deputy examiner. Both of them were young and promising commissioners of the Potions Guild. The young man with golden hair was called Cooper Rickman. He smiled when he saw Macaw. You are worthy of being Professor Snape's disciple. At such a young age, you are going to become a potion apprentice. To be honest, I envy you a little. It would be great if I had such a student. Quote. He extended his hand to shake hands with Mecca, very graceful. Mecca also smiled and responded, You are too kind. I heard that every position in the Potion Guild is held by talents from all walks of life who are selected from thousands of people. Your affirmation makes me feel more confident about this assessment. Cooper laughed heartily and said that Mecca's words were very interesting. He would treat him to a big meal if there was a chance. Mecca smiled and nodded. He looked at the middle-aged man with long black hair and took the initiative to extend his hand to greet him. But the middle-aged man with black hair, Stir Willis, was very cold. He did not extend his hand, but just nodded and said, Hello, in return, nothing else. Seeing this, Cooper hurriedly warmed up the situation and explained with a smile. Stir's personality is like this, cold on the outside but warm on the inside, and he treats me like this. After chatting with Mecca for a few words, he said goodbye to Professor Snape and was going to be busy with the next rating assessment. Then he and Stir hurriedly left. Soon, at night, Mecca felt that the changes in his body had ended. The changes seemed to be quite big. Mecca felt the changes and felt happy physically and mentally. The body seemed to become lighter, the eyes were clearer, and there was a much more abundant and tougher power in the body than before, which was the magic in the body. More importantly, he lay in bed and felt the sleepiness he longed for last night. Finally, I can have a good sleep and go to find the duel master who won 3 gold medals. Mecca was looking forward to what legacy he would get from the duelist. He took the old golden medal in his hand, covered it with a soft quilt, and fell asleep. Soon, he was surprised to find that a familiar person appeared in the story of the duelist. A fierce magic duel was going on in the huge circular arena, and the people in the audience sometimes held their breath and sometimes cheered. Ryan Pierre was wearing a moonlight robe, with long blonde hair curled and hanging on the robe. He nimbly avoided a sword-like flame, and his opponent's figure was reflected in his calm pupils. The opponent is a powerful wizard who once served as the chief auror in the Ministry of Magic. He has rich life and death experience. He is not young, he is much older than Ryan. His temples are already white. He wears one-sided glasses with blue eyes. There is indifference and wisdom in his eyes. The lights on the arena lost their brightness under the powerful magic fluctuations. In the darkness, rays of light struck and intertwined like lightning. The figures of the two people were moving rapidly, and a fierce wind screamed, making everyone in the stands flip over. They screamed in fear and quickly got up again, reluctant to leave. Their eyes were once again attracted by the movement in the ring. The two people on the stage were literally dancing on the tip of a knife. The light on the stage, whether it was like lightning or the flame of a sharp sword, all exuded suffocating fluctuations. Every time it could be a life or death moment. Finally, the huge flames broke through the invisible armor in front of Ryan with sword-like thrusts. There was a crisp sound of broken glass, and the invisible fragments fell to the ground under the firelight. The gray-haired wizard held a wand and looked calmly. Said, "You lose. That's not necessarily the case." Ruyan smiled, his pupils filled with fiery red. After the flaming sword pierced a layer of invisible iron armor, it hit the wall again in front of him, and there was actually a layer of iron armor blocking it. The gray-haired wizard's eyes suddenly froze, and he exerted more pressure. The blocked flames expanded several times, trying to break the armor again. But there was a stream of light on the armor, and the flames were actually transferred behind Ruyan, turning into a huge impact and pouring behind him. The terrifying high temperature burned the ground into fiery red molten lava. "How is that possible?" The wizard with gray hair on his temples was startled. He suddenly reacted and disappeared from the spot. In a moment, he was 10 meters away and stepped out of the whirlpool of space. A dazzling white light flashed in the firelight, piercing the spot where he originally stood. The gray-haired wizard thought he had escaped from the attack range, but as soon as he landed, a wand was pressed against his forehead, with light flickering on it, trying to pierce his head. He raised his head and saw Ryan smiling at him. "You lost," Ryan said. The people outside the stadium immediately burst into loud cheers to celebrate the birth of the new duelist leader. The huge arena was completely hidden in darkness. When the light came on again, it was already a cozy cabin. Ryan Pierre walked into the house tiredly, and a pretty little girl flew up to him. He picked up the little girl with a smile. "Little Ellie, are you good today? Did you listen to your mother?" The little girl nodded heavily, hummed, and rubbed her face into Ryan's arms. "Yes, Ellie is so good, she even helped her mother wash her socks." "Are you back?" A woman in an apron walked out of the back room. She looked at the two of them with a smile. "Dinner is almost ready. There are fish and chips and grilled steak tonight." The little girl immediately cheered, "Great. Fish and chips are my favorite." Soon, the table was filled with hot food, and the family of three sat together. The little girl had already grabbed the fries with her hands, her eyes were dilated and her mouth was full of greasy food. The man smiled and wiped the greasy stains from her face. The woman looked at the deep scars on the man's face with distress, and then at the new wounds on his shoulders, where blood-stained gauze was tied. She hesitated and said, "Ryan, why don't we withdraw from this duelist competition? We have already won the title twice, and any amount of fame is just a burden for us." She explained that now her family is not short of money. The potion store she owned before has improved, and her life will get better and better. When Ryan heard this, he stopped what he was doing. He thought of the deafening cheers in the stands in the past. Those sounds made his blood boil and his heart beat out of his chest many times. He was so intoxicated and loved it. But now someone wants to take it all away. His face gradually turned cold. What do you know? We have won our current lives in the duelist arena. Those potions masters are so arrogant that they will cooperate with us to sell potions because they also take a fancy to my reputation. If I just give up, everything will be in vain. Quote. Besides, dueling is the only way for me to climb the path of wizard. Without this, I'm afraid it will be difficult for me to make progress in magic. No matter how prosperous that kind of life is, what's the use to me? But, the woman wanted to say something more, but the man snorted coldly, and she could only swallow the words. Time passes again, the sun sets outside the window and the moon rises. Ryan Pierre is invited by his friend to congratulate him on becoming the leader of the duelists again. The two exchanged cups, laughed and chatted. The night outside the window was getting darker and the moonlight was disappearing behind the clouds. Several figures suddenly appeared in the house. They were wearing black robes, their faces covered, and a group of people gathered around them. Although Ryan had drunk a lot of wine, he was still alert. He had already stood up and took out the wand from his waist. Who are you? Why did you come here uninvited? He looked solemn, his face was red, and there was already a double image in front of his eyes. The leader smiled and said, Mr. Pierre, fame is like wine, which can make people intoxicated and unable to extricate themselves, but fame is also money. If you don't let others make money, others can only buy your life. The lights in the house were instantly extinguished, and a fierce fight broke out in the darkness. Rays of light intertwined in the night, making deafening sounds, and sometimes screams and blood splashed. When the lights came on again, the three figures had fallen to the ground, and on the other side, Ryan's body was stained with blood, and one arm was missing. He was panting and staring at the remaining two people in front of him. The robes on the two people were torn, revealing blurred faces, and they were also coughing up blood. What a sharp magic! One of them sighed. He was overwhelmed by Ryan's powerful strength, and he still fought one against five after being drunk and killed three people. The other wiped the blood from the corner of his mouth and sneered, but that's it. Ryan felt dizzy and was trying to be alert to their movements. Suddenly, he felt a pain in his back and froze. His chest had been pierced by a sharp blade. He turned his head and looked at the familiar face, unbelievable. Stir, you! Ryan just opened his mouth and blood flowed down. The figure with long black hair approached, and he said to Ryan guiltily. Ryan, they arrested my family, my elderly mother is dying, I can't. You, Ryan's hand that was holding on to the ground finally lost its strength. The duelist who had won many battles fell to the ground with a bang, and his eyes were gradually darkening. In the darkness, he saw his young daughter jumping and jumping, and heard her excited shouting from a distance. Dad, you are back. The wife in an apron held her daughter's hand, and she walked forward to give him a hug when he returned home like before. But before they came, the figure became broken, blurred, and completely disappeared. Ryan lay on the ground, stretched out his hand to them, blood dripping from the corner of his mouth, tears flowing. Little Ariel, Eva, I was wrong. The world suddenly darkened, and what was left was a dark back, calling out to his relatives alone in the darkness. Little Ariel, Eva, the deputy examiner from the Potion Guild actually had such a relationship with this duelist. Mecca Anders was surprised at the figure that appeared in the story, and also surprised at his decisiveness in stabbing without saying a word. Mecca sighed and felt sad for Ryan's experience. He walked out of the darkness, walked towards the outstanding duelist, looked at the pale and bloodless face, and asked softly. What wish do you have that has not been fulfilled? I can help you. The duelist raised his head stiffly, as if he was in a petrified state. He looked at Mecca in a trance and murmured. Little Ariel, Eva, Mecca asked again. When he asked for the third time, his face finally showed some color. He replied. I hope they can live well and not be bullied. He stretched out a cold hand and touched Mecca's forehead. Mecca suddenly had some more information in his mind. This was a way to contact Ryan Pierre's wife and daughter. It was hidden in the old duelist medal. He nodded and accepted the commission. Ryan lowered his head again, fell into that strange state, and continued to call the names of his loved ones. Little Ariel, Eva, Mecca sat on the ground for a while before standing up. He turned around and saw a piece of golden text appearing in the air, rippling with golden ripples. Dual metal carrying regret and longing. Optional legacy. 1. Double armor spell. The armor spell was improved by a talented duelist. He has repeatedly defeated his enemies in unexpected ways with this spell. This double armor spell contains his profound understanding and comprehension of the armor spell. It can be said that he understands the armor spell better than the inventor of the armor spell. 2. A soul thirsty for blood. This is the key for the young duelist to go from an ordinary wizard to the leader of the duelist. Every time the tip of the knife dances, he always feels his blood boiling and his mind is much clearer than usual. In the great terror of life and death, he has a chance to enter the state of understanding the spell and break through the current bottleneck of the spell. 3. Precious of fighting experience. Quote, duelists have experienced dozens of life and death fights in the first 3 years, each of which is enough to kill an ordinary wizard. These valuable experiences have gradually made him an outstanding duelist. The more dangerous the situation is, the more he can think calmly, make correct decisions and judgments, and win the final victory. In the fight, he also realized some efficient spellcasting techniques, which enabled him to cancel the spell in time without being backfired, and quickly connect another spell to deal with the ever-changing crisis. Quote, the next morning, Micah got up from the bed and was about to try to use the duelist medal to contact Ryan's wife and daughter. Suddenly, he saw that Harry had not slept for a long time, and he got up from the bed rubbing his eyes. So early, Micah greeted. Harry yawned. Yeah, there's no way, I have to practice Quidditch today. Quote, he explained that the Quidditch match was coming soon, and the Gryffindor team was practicing extra these days to adjust the team's condition for the upcoming match. After he finished speaking, he ran to wash up, changed his clothes and went out. Mecca waited for Harry to leave and took out the old golden medal. The medal glowed lightly in his hand. He wanted to leave a message in it asking about the status of Ryan's wife and daughter. Mecca Anders thought, in what capacity should she leave this message? This identity must win the trust of Ryan's family and make them willing to tell him the situation. Maybe it's most appropriate to be an old friend of Ruian's. He determined in his mind, recited the incantation to activate the medal, and wrote the letter orally while the medal glowed lightly white. Madam of an old friend, time has changed. I have been traveling abroad and have not seen Ruian for a long time. So when I came back from afar, I never thought that he was already deceased. I felt a little like a world away. It turned out that we met in the duel field. My friend is no longer here. I used various means to find out some of the objects he left behind, and wanted to see if he had left any words. Unexpectedly, I did find a letter he left for me, in which he entrusted me to take care of his family. I have received favors from him, and he knows that I will not refuse, but I don't know how to contact you and win your trust. Fortunately, Ryan left behind this dual medal. He told me exactly how to use the medal in his letter. Mecca used the secret method of using the medal as the key to gaining trust. He then wrote some emotional gossip to pave the way. Finally, he asked Ryan's wife and daughter what troubles they had recently and whether they needed help. He could help. The shallow white light emitted by the medal floated in the air. As he finished dictating, words appeared on the white light, recording everything he said. Mecca likes this way of recording text, it is very efficient. Mecca checked the words, then recited another spell, activating another mysterious pattern in the medal, and the words retracted into the medal, sending messages to distant places in a way that Mecca did not understand. I don't know how long it will take to send a letter, and how long it will take to get a reply. Mecca did not know from Ryan how long it would take for this method of transmission to reach a distant place. He could only hope that the reply would be faster so that Ryan's last wish could be fulfilled as soon as possible. He put away the duelist medal and quickly left the dormitory and went to Professor Snape's office, where he wanted to practice the newly learned whitening potion that can treat trauma and the blood replenishing potion, and consolidate his condition in preparation for the coming potion rating assessment. After the potion rating assessment, Quidditch would also be held, so there was a meeting at Hogwarts at night to discuss the safety issues of the two things, and all the professors were present. Professor Snape arrived there and looked at the other side from time to time. Professor Quirrell, who was sitting there, had been avoiding him recently. Professor Quirrell was so restless that he managed to survive until the end of the meeting. He immediately walked out of the stuffy room. Unexpectedly, he was stopped on the way back to the office. "Your injuries are actually healed," Professor Snape said. "Did you make a mistake?" Professor Quirrell stammered, doubting that he had never been injured. Professor Snape sneered and didn't reply to his words. He grabbed his arm and lifted up a corner of his sleeve. Surprisingly, he found that it was clean and tidy, with no signs of blood or even broken bones. "What are you doing?" Professor Quirrell was angry, and he quickly withdrew his arm. He said hello to Professor McGonagall in the distance and ran to talk to her to avoid Professor Snape's inspection. Professor Snape stared at him for a while and left alone. Professor Quirrell, who finally got rid of Snape, walked on the corridor back to his office. He accidentally touched the side of his face, and there was an inconspicuous gray patch there. This was the mark, or sequelae, left by taking a medicine that was included in the list of banned drugs by the Ministry of Magic to quickly heal the wound. Professor Quirrell hurriedly passed by the temporary office of the Potions Guild, where the lights were bright and two figures were arguing in front of the window. It turns out that the two examiners from the Potions Guild are quite conflicted. Professor Quirrell listened. They were talking about the departure of a subordinate. This subordinate had a good relationship with Deputy Examiner Stern, so he supported his promotion to become a deacon above the commissioner. But now this subordinate has been transferred away, and it seems to be related to Cooper. Coincidentally, Cooper is also one of the candidates for deacon. "Quirinas," a hoarse voice suddenly warned him. "Don't get close to people from the Potions Guild. Someone might be able to recognize the origin of this patch." Quirrell heard the reminder and saw that the figure in front of the window had walked away, and there was a sound of opening the door. He quickly left the place and hurried into the night. On November 3rd, the sun was shining brightly, leaving a little bit of brilliance in the shade of the trees. The day of the potion rating assessment has arrived. The potion assessment requires quietness, so the assessment site is placed in a spacious and unused classroom that was once built. Only the professor and related personnel are present to maintain order. Cooper, the examiner in charge of this assessment, stood on the stage and watched all the people participating in the assessment enter. He suddenly smiled and introduced the best of these people to Professor Snape on the side. The young man with the light beard is an apprentice in a famous potion workshop. He usually works next to the potion master in the workshop and has learned potions there for almost 10 years. "I have seen his method of refining potions. He is very skilled and his success rate is much higher than that of ordinary people. I think he will be the only one to get the quota this time." Quote, "The girl in the red dress has parents who are both excellent potion masters. Under the influence of her family education, she also shows amazing talent in potions and is good at refining some healing potions. The potions she has made are of high quality. As for the young man with chestnut hair in the middle, he is the child of a deacon of the Potion Guild. He happened to be traveling here. He has a very good talent in potions. He is probably the biggest competitor of your student." Cooper explained that this young man has lived in the guild since he was a child. He was influenced by his parents and refined his first bottle of potion at the age of 13. Later, his talent was discovered and his performance became more and more outstanding. Some high-level guild members evaluated that he would be a future potion master. Professor Snape listened and nodded occasionally in response. On the other side, the deputy examiner Stir was introducing the relevant matters of this assessment. "The first place in this assessment has such benefits." Mecca was surprised that the first place in this assessment would receive a special potion apprentice medal. With this medal in hand, he can buy most of the medicinal materials in the Potion Guild at a 10% discount. For him, saving costs means that he can make more money from a bottle of potion, right? As a pauper, he now sees the glittering gold galleons waving at him. "We must get this kind of wool." Therefore, Mecca decided to get this special medal that smells like money. Deputy Examiner Stir finished the introduction and arranged for the people who came to take the test to take their seats. Just as Mecca was about to go to his seat, he was stopped by a young man with long chestnut hair. The young man with long chestnut hair said, "Are you the student of the potion master Severus Snape? Everyone came from far away because of you. You have a lot of face." Mecca frowned. Someone was trying to make trouble. He asked back, "Who are you?" "Dane Craig. The young man with long chestnut hair smiled, you will soon know the value of this name. Don't expect to win the first place this time. That's mine. I hope everyone will support it and subscribe more.